Good morning. I'm Darcy Soss from the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston and a member of the conference production team. Before we begin, I'd like to share some instructions to help you best experience today's event. You may view the full conference agenda and speaker bios by selecting the conference website or presenter bio buttons in the top right of your event screen. Please plan to submit any questions or comments using the pose a question or comment button, which is also at the top right of the event screen. You may view the video or slides presented here in full screen by selecting the maximize icons at the top of either frame. Finally, I want to advise you that we're recording today's event. This recording will be available at the conference website tomorrow. The views expressed in the presentations and discussions today are those of the authors and do not indicate concurrence by the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, the principals of the Board of Governors, or the Federal Reserve System. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Joe Peek, a vice president and economist at the Boston Fed, who will formally open today's conference.
Thank you, Darcy. It is my privilege to welcome you to the Bank's 65th Economic Research Conference. The title of the conference is The Implications of High Leverage for Financial Instability Risk, Real Economic Activity, and the Appropriate Policy Responses. Even before the COVID-19 crisis, the high levels of debt of businesses, households, and government were already a concern, both for risk to the stability of the financial system and to the real economy. Credit availability, whether too much or too little, has long been a concern insofar as fluctuations in credit availability can amplify business cycles, with too easy credit leading to higher booms and credit that is too tight leading to deeper recessions. Moreover, easy credit can contribute to asset price bubbles that can lead to financial instability and severe damage to the real sector when they finally pop. Because asset price bubbles are difficult to identify ex ante, and because cleanly separating credit supply shocks from credit demand shocks is a difficult endeavor, determining the appropriate policy responses is often not straightforward, especially given the various trade-offs and spillovers effects that are involved. For example, even though we headed into the pandemic-induced recession with particularly high leverage in the business sector, policies were implemented to enhance credit availability, raising leverage even further. In part, this was due to the fear that troubled but viable firms, especially smaller firms, would be cut off from the credit that they required to survive the recession. Another consideration that may have contributed to the policy response is that the long period of extremely low interest rates meant that the heavy debt burden was not matched with an equally high debt service burden. The purpose of this conference is to enhance our understanding of the role that higher leverage rates play in macroeconomic performance and the nature of the associated risk. We look broadly at the business sector, the household sector, and the commercial real estate sector. The analyses discussed incorporate discussions of the continuing evolution of our financial system from both financial innovation and financial regulation, and the role played in heightening or mitigating risks to financial stability in the real economy. The conference ends with two panels of distinguished economists who will discuss the policy implications and potential policy solutions for addressing the rise in leverage. Recently, we have certainly been living in interesting times. While the expression, "may you live in interesting times," is typically used in an ironic manner to place a curse on someone, I don't consider being interesting as necessarily a bad thing. In that non-ironic light, my wish is that we have interesting times for the next 3 days as we consider and discuss important issues that are particularly relevant to today's economic environment. And now I would like to introduce Kenneth Montgomery, Interim President and CEO of the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston.
Thank you, Joe. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for the Boston Fed's 65th Annual Economic Conference, the second of two economic conferences hosted by the bank this fall. We are pleased to have our speakers, participants, and audience members join us this week to discuss and analyze a very important topic, the implications of high leverage. As noted in the title of the conference, we want to explore the implications of high leverage for financial instability risk, for real economic activity, and for policy responses. I am grateful to my colleagues in the Boston Fed's Research Department for putting together another in a long line of rigorous and relevant economic conferences. Our intention with these conferences has always been to convene experts who can explore important economic issues and contribute to improving policy and outcomes. So I appreciate the opportunity to say a few words of introduction and an overview as we open the 65th such gathering. I'll begin by saying the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston has long been engaged in studying financial instability risks, specifically the implications of these risks for the real economy. Eric Rosengren, who recently retired as president of the bank, studied and spoke about these issues, first as a researcher and later as a policymaker, often working alongside Joe Peek and his colleagues. All told, the bank has for some time emphasized the important role of credit in the economy and the importance of financial stability constraints in monetary policy deliberation. This focus at the Boston Fed has allowed us to contribute in significant ways to policy discussions and decisions at some critical moments for the U.S. economy. Two such examples, about which I will touch on only very briefly, are the 2008 financial crisis and the COVID-19 pandemic. Indeed, in both cases, we had the opportunity to play key roles in implementing and administering Federal Reserve System programs intended to help provide liquidity to markets and support credit availability to the private sector. The first example I'll point to, the Great Recession of 2008 and 2009, which was triggered and exacerbated by a financial crisis, drove home the critical importance of having a stable and resilient financial system. Policymakers have since taken many actions to strengthen regulation of financial institutions in order to minimize the risk of a repeat financial crisis and resulting disastrous collapse in economic activity of the sort we experienced during the Great Recession. Take, for instance, the introduction of stress testing for large banks and a number of other regulatory measures that led to a relatively well-capitalized banking system. In contrast, over the past decade, we have seen other sectors' indebtedness climbing to potentially concerning levels. In particular, by some measures, non-financial business leverage is historically high, perhaps due in part to extremely low interest rates globally. Our conference aims to analyze the risk of such high leverage for the broader economy and also provide a forum for discussion of appropriate policy responses targeted at mitigating those risks. I'll turn now to the second example, focused on the Fed's response to the economic emergency brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. The COVID-19 outbreak in the U.S. starting in March 2020 had a devastating impact on many households and businesses, especially small businesses. Many business owners lost revenue streams overnight as they had to substantially curtail or even shut down operations. Millions of workers lost their jobs. The abrupt and drastic disruptions, along with extremely elevated uncertainty, caused widespread turmoil in financial markets. Confronted with such unprecedented disruptions to the U.S. economy, public policymakers, both monetary and fiscal, took decisive actions to support households, businesses, and markets in order to stabilize the financial sector and help minimize damage to the real economy. The Federal Reserve, with support from the Treasury Department, introduced a number of liquidity and credit facilities to ensure businesses, as well as consumers, could readily access the credit they needed in order to weather the pandemic-induced interruptions. The Main Street Lending Program, one such facility that was administered by the Boston Fed on behalf of the Federal Reserve System, supported continued operations of small and medium-sized businesses despite the pandemic disruptions. The bank's 65th annual research conference is intended to contribute to our understanding of how leverage affects stability risks and ultimately the resilience of the real economy. In particular, the effect of leverage on key macro and economic variables such as employment and investment. In addition to a focus on the business sector, the conference will also include analysis of the effects of household leverage on the severity of the Great Recession, as well as analysis of how the commercial real estate sector can best recover after the pandemic. Another particularly timely topic to be considered is the likely difficult trade-off for policymakers going forward, stemming from the unfortunate side effects of some of the policy measures taken to combat the pandemic, given that they added more debt to businesses' already debt-laden balance sheets. I am confident the insights we take from the discussions and presentations during the next 3 days can contribute to improving the formulation of public policy going forward. Again, I want to thank our organizers, presenters, discussants, and audience members for taking part. At this point, it is my pleasure to introduce the moderator of the first day of the conference, Benjamin Friedman. Professor Friedman is the William Joseph Maier Professor of Political Economy at Harvard University. Professor Friedman's work is focused on monetary policy, including the optimal conduct of policy and the transmission of policy through the financial system to the real economy, as well as the role of central banks in maintaining financial stability and formulating appropriate policy responses to various crises. More recently, Professor Friedman has broadened even further his distinguished portfolio of work with his newest book, Religion and the Rise of Capitalism, which provides a fundamental reassessment of the foundation of current day economics and shows how religious thinking has shaped economic thinking. Please join me in welcoming Professor Friedman, truly an expert on the topics that will be central to this conference. And again, thank you for your participation. Professor Friedman, I'll turn it to you.
Thanks very much, Ken. I'm honored to take part in this conference and especially to moderate the proceedings on the first day. I think Ken and Joe have both done an excellent job of explaining what the focus is and why it's of concern both to the Federal Reserve and more broadly. We're focused on the current environment in which we have the unusual combination of high corporate leverage and also low interest rates, not something most of us had expected to occur simultaneously, but here we are. And this morning we have three papers. The first session is on the macroeconomic implications of this combination of high leverage and low interest rates. And then we move on in the second paper to implications for another side of the Federal Reserve's activities, namely the regulatory side. And then in the third paper early in the afternoon, we'll look at the implications of this high leverage, low interest rate combination for the Federal Reserve's response and the macroeconomy in general during the coronavirus pandemic. Now, if you'll indulge me for a moment before we turn to the first paper, I'm very aware that this is the first time I've participated in a Federal Reserve Bank of Boston conference since Eric Rosengren stepped down as president of the bank. And I want to take a moment to thank Eric, not just for me personally, although yes, for me personally, but on behalf of the entire academic community in New England and more broadly, for all that he's done over the years, both through his own research and also through his sympathy to research and his enthusiasm and understanding of what research is all about. I think we all are very aware of the role of the Federal Reserve as a sponsor of research, as a listener to research, as a participant in the research process. And I can think of nobody at the Federal Reserve, not just in Boston, but more generally over the years, who has been more interested, more engaged, more supportive than Eric was. So Eric, if you're participating in this conference, please know that all of us appreciate what you did, and we are very grateful to you, and we acknowledge your many contributions over the years. Thank you. We're now ready to turn to our first paper of the day. The presenter is Efraim Benmelech from Northwestern University. Efraim, you have 25 minutes in which to present your paper.
Thank you very much, Ben, and it's a pleasure to be here in the conference. And I will talk today about corporate debt, and you can tell from the title of the paper, Leverage and the Macroeconomy Implications of Low Interest Rates for Corporate Debt. You know, as we've just heard from Ben, the phenomena of low interest rates and high corporate debt is something that we have seen in recent years. And, you know, we would like to understand it a little bit better and analyze the risks that are involved in such an environment. So I would like to start with the first graph that you can see here on the slide. And what this graph does is to depict the evolution of debt. You can call it corporate debt, or to be more precise, U.S. non-financial corporate business debt in billions of dollars. And you can see fairly clearly how, you know, it went up over the years. We can see the rise in corporate debt just before the global financial crisis. So the rate at which debt grew accelerated. And then you can see that around 07, 08, we see the decline. So that's the delevering of corporations in the US. But that delevering didn't last for very long. And starting around 2011, we see an increased tendency to take on even more debt. And the rise in debt has been accelerating again. And even if you ignore the very last points where you see a very steep increase in debt driven mostly by COVID, you see that even before COVID, corporations in the US have been taking more and more debt and have becoming more levered. So you can see this is the segment of the graph that I've marked in red to make sure that we pay attention. And I believe that that's the segment that many are worried about. Debt levels are rising. And the concern is that we know that debt often comes with some adverse consequences in financial crisis, in financial distress. So the questions that I would like to ask are, what are the implications of high debt, and especially in particular in an environment of low interest rates, for the macroeconomy? So here are some questions that we may want to ask. Let me start with the first question. Should we be concerned about the potential adverse effect of high debt burden on financial stability and, you know, for the real economy? Another question to ask, that's the second bullet point. What role does a greater reliance on credit by non-financial firms play in output and employment fluctuations? There is ample research that shows that, you know, investment levels and employment are sensitive to the ability of firms to fund them, to have spare debt capacity, to have liquidity. Should we be concerned that such a high level of debt would have adverse consequences for the real economy? And finally, the question that is specific for the period that we are witnessing, are the adverse effects of high leverage potentially less damaging in a low interest rate environment? And we have no assurance that the low interest rate environment that we are at now will continue, but at least we can look backward and ask ourselves, you know, have we seen recently different patterns in the way that firms operate given their high debt levels in an environment with low interest rates? So I would like to start by giving a few answers. Those are not complete answers, but I will justify and try to show you the data or the analysis behind these answers later. But for those of you who are perhaps less patient, you know, here are some takeaways. For sure, elevated debt levels, they always pose some risk for financial stability and for the real economy. Debt always brings some risk, and that's what we teach to our students, and that's what we show in research. And I think that the Federal Reserve should pay attention to those risks and to those level of debt. But I also want to argue, however, that this debt cycle is somewhat different. And all of the, in my presentation today, in my analysis in the paper, I'm using data on publicly traded companies. So when I refer to large firms and small firms, this is within the universe of publicly traded companies. You know, I didn't analyze small businesses. It's all fairly large firms. What we have seen among that pool of large firms is that the largest borrowers are the largest firms among the publicly traded companies. And those have stable cash flows and they have fairly high cash holdings, a phenomena that I will refer to in a few slides. The interesting result is that smaller firms, and again, those are smaller firms that are publicly traded, we see an interesting pattern that has been documented before, but is only accelerated in recent years, and for sure during COVID, is that those firms are borrowing money and they hoard the cash. Means that they borrow money and leave it in cash on their balance sheet, and they do it at the same time. And we see this phenomena in particular in times of low interest rates. Now, in finance, we have another definition to leverage, which is what we call net leverage. And net leverage is defined as debt minus cash. If you assume that cash is the opposite of debt, then that net leverage tells you if the firm takes all of the cash that it has and pay off its debt, how much debt is it effectively left with? And as I will show you, when we calculate such net leverage for the smaller firms, we find that smaller firms have now historically low net leverage. They have net leverage, they have leverage that is high, but in terms of net leverage, it is historically low. And again, the intuition for that is that net leverage takes into account the two sides of the balance sheet, how much debt you have and how much cash you have. And when they hold much more cash, even if they increase their debt, the net leverage has been declining recently. Another result, that's the third bullet point, which is consistent with what I've just described, is that firms are not using the debt that they issue to fund what we call real activity. As I will show you, firms are using less of the funds that they issue to finance investment in property, plant, and equipment or capital expenditure. They use less and less of the debt that they issue to fund those real activities. Instead, they save most of the debt that they issue. And around 30% of every net dollar of issuance, they save, they put it in cash. And finally, the last point that I would like to make is that at least when we look back now, and for sure, lower interest rates have led firms to take on more debt, but even with that increase in leverage, low interest rates have led to a reduction or decline in the interest expenses that firms pay because there was such a dramatic decline in interest rates. So even if a firm, let's say, increased its leverage from 20 to 25%, the decline in interest rates has been so dramatic that the interest expenses that they pay have been actually lower. And as I will show you, that have led to a relaxation of financial constraints of firms. So again, we heard from Ben before about this very unique situation we are at of high debt and low interest rates. And at least when we look back, and there is always a risk that interest rates would go up, as I mentioned before, it seemed that the reduction in interest rate have relaxed financial constraints of firms, even though they took on more debt. Okay, so let's see some figures, and I will try to show you most of the findings in figures, so they are more intuitive and easier to grasp. Let's look at this graph, cash holdings and the 10-year treasury rates from 1970 to 2018. And what do you see here? Well, the red line shows you the rate on the 10-year treasury. And you can see, you know, when it was very high during the early 80s which was followed by the secular decline in rates. So basically what you see is the decline in interest rates. The blue line shows you the average cash holding by firms. And in the paper, I explain again exactly how I construct it to overcome selection issues with firms. And what you see with the blue line is that on average, firms are holding more and more cash. And if we look into the 70s, firms held, you know, between 2.5% and 4% of their assets in cash. And now when you look into recent years, it's about 10%. It's about 10% or slightly below. So dramatic increase in cash holdings, dramatic decline in interest rates. The question is, you know, are they related? How are they related? And what are the implications of this relationship? So let's try to dig a little bit deeper into this phenomena of increased cash holding. What I've done is to sort firms, and again, those are CompuStat firms, or those are publicly traded companies, into size quartiles. And when I refer to the first size quartile, I refer to the firms that are the smallest in the smallest size quartile of CompuStat. Okay, so those are the smallest firms in CompuStat. And you can see that over time, their cash holdings have been increasing. And I define here cash holding as cash and short-term investment divided by assets. For sure in 2020 and to some extent already in 2019, because some firms have fiscal years that appeared only later and they already knew about the global pandemic, you see very high tendency to hold cash. But even if you ignore those two outliers at the right end of the scale, 2020 and 2019, even if you ignore those, can still see a significant increase in cash holding by those firms that has risen from about 10% in the year 2000 to about 25% in the year 2018. Firms are holding more and more cash. And again, that corresponds to the argument that I've made before that net leverage has been declining for those firms because of the increase in debt has been less than the increase in cash that they hold. If we move now to the second size quartile, those are the firms that are not the smallest in this universe of publicly traded companies, but are the second smallest, you see similar pattern. Although it is true that they peaked in terms of cash holding pre-COVID around 09 at 15%. But even before COVID, even if you ignore the last two or the last one outlier, you see that there has been an increase in cash holding by those companies. And for sure, cash holdings, which are around between 12 and 15%, are much higher than the levels that they've been in the 1990s of about 5%. When we move to larger firms, and now it's the third size quartile, or the firms that are in the third size quartile among publicly traded companies, you still see the increase in cash holdings. Although again, the peak was around the global financial crisis, but even after the global financial crisis, you can see cash holdings of, you know, 6.5%, which are much higher than the holdings of around 3% in the 1990s. And finally, when we move to the largest firms, those in the fourth size quartile, we also see for them an increase in cash holdings, albeit from a very low level or a fairly low level in the 1990s of 1.5% to about 4.5% during the global financial crisis. And in recent years, there's been some decline in that, but still it's above 2%, so higher than where it was in the 1990s. And again, I'm ignoring the outlier of cash holdings in COVID-19. So, you know, this is an interesting number, cash holdings, or an interesting parameter that we do not always pay too much attention to, but I will argue it is very important. Cash holdings by smaller CompuStat firms increased from about 5% in 1970s to over 20% in 2015 and remained elevated since then. Just to summarize what I've just said, and we see similar patterns for firms in the second size quartile. And I want to mention again that even large firms also increased their cash holding over the same time period, although over a longer interval. And the results are not driven by the COVID-19 pandemic, in which cash holdings increased even further. So, you know, this is a conference about leverage. Why are we talking about cash? Because that, you know, I would argue we would like to calculate net leverage. And again, just to remind you, net leverage is debt minus cash. And you can see here the median leverage or the median company in CompuStat. You can see the median leverage, that's the blue line. And it seems to have been stable, although increased, slightly increased and then slight decline before COVID. But then if you look into the median net leverage, you see that it declined significantly. Now, of course, because this is a median, this is driven mostly by the smallest firms in the first and the second size quartile. We can construct this graph quartile by quartile, as we have done before. Sorry, so this is the first size quartile. So, of course, you see the median net leverage has declined to zero. In the second quartile, so the second smallest firms, you see that the pattern is very similar. Among the larger firms, the pattern is slightly different. So among the largest firms, those in the third and in the fourth quartile, net leverage has not been trending down as it is for the smaller firms, but it seems to be quite stable. So this is the third quartile. And here is the fourth quartile. And you know, you look into the fourth quartile, and it seems that by leverage, we seem to be in, I won't say in all times high, but you know, higher than what we have seen in most of the 2000s and for sure most of the 1990s. But when you compare it to net leverage, you know, we are not that different from where we were in the 2000s or in the 1990s. So here is the aggregate picture, if you wish, median leverage and net leverage. The blue line shows you median leverage for every firm in CompuStat. The red line shows you net leverage. And the point that I'm making here is that yes, firms are holding more, firms have borrowed more and have higher leverage ratios, but they also hold a lot of the debt that they borrow in cash. And the result is lower net leverage. Okay, so I have a few more figures and for those, a few more tables, and those of you who are interested can follow them in the paper. Let me skip them just for brevity and talk about some regressions that I have run. So in those regressions, I try to understand what are the determinants of net leverage. So you can run a regression of where the dependent variable is net leverage and have some explanatory variables. Or you can decompose net leverage into leverage and cash. And most importantly, I wanted to see how this is behaving or what is the, what are the, how do the determinants change when interest rates change? And the results are consistent with what we have seen. Cash holdings tend to increase by smaller firms when interest rates are low. And debt issuance by smaller firms tend to be lower when interest rates are low. In contrast, for larger firms, cash holding tend to slightly decline when interest rates are low, but issuance of debt is increasing when interest rates are low. And to some extent, this is driven by the ability of large firms to access the bond market in times of low interest rates. Okay, so let me move now to the second question that I would like to explore. What do firms do with debt? To assess the impact of high leverage on the real economy, we need to gain better understanding of what firms do with the debt they raise. Are the funds used to finance investment, pay for operating costs, or being hoarded as cash? And the difficulty is that firms do not report how they allocate the capital they raise to different uses. So what I'm proposing in the paper is a new methodology to allocate debt into the different uses. And you can look into the technique in the paper, but here is what I find. I find, for example, that If you look over the last 40 years, what are the financial and operational uses of gross debt issuance, you see that about 54 cents on the dollar goes to repayments of debt, and about 9 cents on the dollar go to investment, 7 cents on the dollar go to is being hoarded in cash, and 13 cents on the dollar go to acquisition. But the more interesting comparison is to look into what do firms do with net debt issuance, which means with the debt, the money that they have after they've paid all of their maturing debt. And what we find here is that 26 cents on the dollar goes to cash holding, and about 14 cents on the dollar goes to investment, about 28 cents on the dollar goes to acquisition, and 13 cents on the dollar goes to operating expenses such as SG&A. Perhaps a more stark comparison is to compare, you know, how it used to be and how it is now. Here are the 1970s. In the 1970s, slightly less than a third of the debt that would be issued, the net debt that would be issued, would go to investment, to capital expenditure. That's the red slice that you see here. And only 9 cents on the dollar would go to cash. When you fast forward to, you know, the last decade from 2010 to 2019, again, before COVID, only 6 cents on the dollar go to investment. So it's about a fifth of what we have seen before. And on the other hand, now the red slice is cash. You know, about 27 cents out of net debt issuance are being hoarded in cash. And that's, again, consistent with the fact that firms are holding more cash and also investing less. What do firms do with debt? Let me just summarize what we have just seen. Dramatic changes in the use of debt. In the 70s and 80s, much more of the debt was used for financing investment. In recent years, firms choose to raise debt, and instead of investing it in property, plant, and equipment, they hoard the cash and increase corporate saving. And these results are consistent with the facts documented earlier about the increased tendency to hold cash, what I've just shown you, and also with the literature on the decline in investment. I mean, it's hard to say that firms are constrained in one way or another. Of course, they make the joint decision of how much cash to hoard and how much to invest. But we see that in recent years, there has been an increased tendency to hold the proceeds of net debt issuance in cash rather than invest it. Okay, let me move to another aspect of low interest rates and debt, which is the fact that when interest rates declined, interest expenses also declined. And what you see in this graph is the yield at issuance of bonds by credit rating going back to 1980. The blue dots are AAA rated companies. The red dots are BB rated companies. And, you know, obviously the yield on the lower, on the higher rated bonds is lower than those of the higher rated bonds, but you see the decline from about 15% to about 3 or 4% recently. So how did it affect companies? Here's one way to look into it. Again, I'm showing you the median leverage ratio, which is the red line. But in addition to the median leverage ratio, I'm also showing you the median interest expenses to debt, which is effectively what you pay on the debt, which is the blue line. So as leverage fluctuates and goes down and perhaps goes up, the interest that they pay on the debt goes down. You can read how the interest that they pay on the debt from the left scale, and you can read the leverage from the right scale. So again, debt is increasing, leverage is increasing, but because of the decline in interest expenses, the cost of debt is declining. Here is another way to look into it: median leverage and interest expenses to assets, exactly the same picture. Just to give you some numbers, if you look into what firms paid in the median percentage that firms paid on the debt, 1975 was around 8.4%. In 2015, that was 5.1%. If you look into investment grade firms, they used to pay in 1990 9.9% on their debt. By 2015, they pay less than half of it, which is 4.5%. And the decline can be found also among non-investment grade companies who paid in 1990 12.6% on their debt. And by 2015, again, pay 6.2%, so basically cut it by a half. So the decline in interest rate had a dramatic effect on interest expenses that firms pay. Okay, let me skip this slide table 8. You can look into it in the paper. And again, in terms of interest expenses relative to either total debt or total assets, they declined significantly, driven by the decline in the treasuries, in the treasury rates. Median interest expenses to assets were 3% in 1980, declining to 2.4% in 2000, 1.6% in 2010, and 1.3% in 2020. What I've done next was to run a set of regressions, which I'm not going to get into with too much details today, and try to explore the effect of interest expenses on investment. And the short answer is that reduced interest expenses because of the decline in the base rates have led firms to invest relatively more, or so to speak, the constraint that we think that we have in interest expenses, the need to service the debt that they have has declined for firms and freed up more cash for the firms. Now, in a margin, it did help them to invest a little bit more. But as we have seen before, most of the funds that we see now from debt issuance are not going for investment. They go for other uses. It's not necessarily because of financial constraints. It's for other reasons that I haven't explored in the paper, but it's the well-documented phenomena that has been shown again and again that firms are investing proportionally less than they used to. Okay, so let me perhaps summarize the findings. Again, I want to say I'm not here to say that we shouldn't be worried about debt. Elevated debt levels are a reason for concern. However, I want to argue the cycle that we have seen, and I'm referring mostly to the cycle that we have seen before COVID, although there are some similarities in COVID, is that this cycle is different. Firms appear more levered, but net leverage has declined, especially for about 50% of the firms in CompuStat, in particular for the smaller CompuStat firms, those in the first and the second size quartile. If you think about debt from just gross debt use, debt is used mostly to repay debt. But if you think about debt from a net debt issuance perspective, the importance of debt in financing investment, with the exception of acquisitions, has declined over the years. You know, we don't count acquisitions as a form of investment because that acquisitions do not lead to the creation, typically, of acquisition of new capital, mostly in ownership structure. But we can think about acquisitions perhaps as a way to increase efficiency in the economy. And at least from that perspective, debt is financing the means to increase efficiency in the economy, but that doesn't result necessarily in more investment. And finally, I want to say that the interest expense channel is important. And with lower interest rate, financial constraint has been likely relaxed. Everything that I've said is when we look backward and look into the interaction between high debt levels and low interest rates, one can imagine that when interest rates would change their course, the results would be very different. Thank you very much. And I turn back to Ben.
Okay, thank you very much, F.A. Appreciate that. And our discussant is Moritz Schularick from the University of Bonn. Moritz, are you there?
I am here. Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Boston Fed, for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to discuss this paper. Also, Ben, it's a great pleasure to meet you here virtually. You might not remember, but I was a graduate student in Berlin and you visited, and you've been an inspiration for my work ever since. So very happy to see you again. And Effie, thanks so much for writing a fantastic paper. And we had the opportunity to discuss a little bit along the way. It's an important paper, and we both agree there is interesting work to be done on what that. But let me start with a quick overview of what's going to come and what I think about Effie's work. I think this paper that Effie presented is thought-provoking, it's diligent, and it's very topical. It has a strong message, I think, even Effie rightly moderated a little bit at the end. The paper studies the firm distribution of leverage, the uses of debt, and the interest expenses of US-listed firms using CompuStat data. And overall, I think this has become very clear and very sharp as well in the presentation, is that Effie and overall, we should not worry too much about corporate debt at this juncture, because small and fragile firms with low leverage, firms increasingly borrowed to hoard cash, and net leverage has even declined for many firms. And at the same time, interest expenses have fallen substantially. I will, in my discussion, try to provide some context and revisit the key style aspects of Effie's paper. I will aim to clarify how the paper contributes to the debate about post-pandemic corporate debt and its potential impact on the real economy. And I will aim in the last maybe 5 minutes of my discussion to connect Effie's findings to one of the big macro debates out there, namely, why are real interest rates so low and where do all the savings come from? And I think Effie's up to something very interesting here, talking about rising savings on corporate balance sheet and rising cash levels. I will make the point that likely what Effie is telling us here, using data for listed firms, has macro implications and shapes this the world we live in right now in a very important way, and maybe in an underappreciated way. Let me start with some context for this paper. I think what is clear is that there are widespread fears out there about debt overhang from a decade of rapid corporate debt growth, slowing down the recovery from the pandemic. And what we all have in mind, I think, is a replay of the post-2008-9 experience, where arguably household balance sheets were overly leveraged, where some balance sheet repair had to take place, and that household debt overhang and that repair took a long time and contributed to what was, in hindsight, and at the time, it clearly felt like a very slow and painful and drawn out recovery from the 2008-9 events. It is, and Effie has shown us the chart, corporate debt over GDP, the corporate debt over GDP ratio has risen strongly before and during the pandemic. Important reminder that also during COVID, governments around the world have supported in one way or the other the business sector with access to liquidity facilities and similar vehicles. And we also know that high corporate debt on corporate balance sheet can depress investment and growth. It's a seminal paper by Maier's 1977 that tells us when corporations are overly indebted, they have incentives to not invest and actually scale down expenditures that have delayed rewards, also hiring and other kinds of investment. So we look at the micro evidence, micro studies that look at the effect of debt overhang. They often confirm negative effects of corporate debt overhang on firm level investment. This being said, and I mentioned here it's a very nice paper by Shevin and Luke and co-authors using European data, that identification is typically difficult. It is true that European data are more granular and have been used a lot, but you know, for the post-Great Recession or for the post-financial crisis era, there is an issue with credit supply and demand, as the banking system in Europe was also impaired for some time. So it's unclear where these effects come from. What Effie does is his paper brings new and important evidence on the financial situation of listed US companies. Let me start with the macro perspective, because I mentioned at the beginning that these are the fears at the moment. Will we see potentially a repeat or replay of the post-2008 household debt overhang, but this time on the corporate side. The message, the long-term perspective clearly supports the idea that we have seen a quite spectacular corporate debt boom in the past 20 to 30 years. So this chart gives you for 18 advanced economies from work that I've done with Oscar, Martin, and Ellen, gives you a long-run perspective on corporate debt to GDP levels all the way from the 19th century until today. And if you zoom in on that post-2000 or post-1990 period, you will see that within a relatively short period, across advanced economies, corporate debt levels have increased by something like 50 percentage points of GDP. So that is a serious, this is a serious business sector credit boom that we've been in. When we zoom in on the credit, on the corporate debt boom of the past decade and look at some, at a number of countries here, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, UK, US, and China, you'll see, however, that there is substantial heterogeneity among countries. And we're most interested today in the US experience. We see that there's been some deleveraging after 2010, and then a period of rather pronounced re-leveraging relative to GDP, I should say, for the business sector as a whole since about 2015. But it's also clear that in international comparison, countries like France, evidently China, had a much more pronounced corporate debt booms. And in other countries, Italy, or even Germany to some degree, the corporate sector actually deleveraged over the past decade. So also internationally, the picture is quite heterogeneous. If we look at the distribution of corporate debt booms in history, so this is the distribution of 5-year changes in corporate debt over GDP for these over the long run for these 18 economies. You see these vertical lines here that effectively mark the past 5 years. So if you focus on the red line, that's the credit boom in the distribution that the US economy has seen between 2015 and 2020 over that 5-year period. So it is on the right-hand side of the distribution. It is certainly one of the larger credit booms judging by historical standards. But you can also see it's not in the far right tail. And other countries, you see the other vertical lines, it's much more mixed than what we see for especially the US and France, who were the main advanced economies with large buildups of corporate debt in the past decade. So what do we know about the aftermath of corporate debt booms from a macro perspective? Well, what we know is that the aftermath typically tends to be benign. This is what this chart shows you. On the left-hand side, I show the change in business credit lagged by 5 years and ask how does it predict GDP outcomes going forward? And you see basically a straight blue line that the slope is basically zero. On the right-hand side, exactly the same exercise for household debt booms. And here you see that well-known result also in the research of me and Sophie Verne and others, that household debt booms are typically predictive of negative outcomes, risk to growth, also risk to the distribution of future outcomes, whereas corporate debt booms do not. There's one exception, and we know this thanks to the recent work by Carsten Miller and Emil Werner, namely, if corporate debt booms look a lot like household debt booms in the sense that the credit flows into the non-tradable sector, into the more domestic economy, where potentially productivity growth is lower, the aftermath of corporate debt booms tends to be negative as well, whereas corporate debt booms that go in the tradable sector on the right-hand side tend to be associated with positive growth outcomes. I think this is a very nice way to reconcile the different literatures about financial deepening being beneficial to the economy and the literature about credit booms being detrimental to the economy because they forecast lower growth and potentially even crisis outcomes. It depends a lot on what we use the debt and the credit for. So now let me come to the picture of the last decade. Do we see red flags here? Was the credit boom of the past decade in the US, in France, and in other countries particularly heavy on the non-tradable sector? And the answer is compared to the tradable sector on the right in the left-hand chart. And even if we're only eyeballing the graph, it doesn't look like we were, and I think we know this from other data, we were not caught in a typical sort of, domestic asset boom bust situation. I think the experience of Japan in the 1980s and 1990s comes to mind. The corporate credit boom of the past decade, even sort of in the countries where it was quite pronounced, like the US and France, was more mixed. It went both into the tradable, actually more into the tradable than into the non-tradable sector. And again, broadly speaking, even that sort of important caveat that corporate debt booms that are heavily concentrated in the non-tradable sector can have detrimental outcomes. That caveat does not seem to apply right here. Okay, so now let me come, this is the macro backdrop, let me come in the second half of my discussion to the balance sheet perspective from FB's paper, which is super interesting and I think complementary to what I've just told you. Because what FB does is he goes to the Compustat database and looks at the financial situation, at the whole balance sheet of US listed firms. And what I did for this discussion, I went essentially to the same data set and didn't redo what FB did because I did not have to do that. It's an excellent paper, but I just thought I'll just present some stylized tracks that, broadly speaking, support what FE did. So what you see here is total debt over assets. They've been on a downward trend, confirming what FE told us, that if you scale debt not by GDP, but by assets of the firm, and on the left-hand side, you see the median firm, on the right-hand side, you see aggregate debt to aggregate assets, that would be broadly comparable to the flow of funds data for the listed business sector. You see, like, relative to levels in 1990, we're barely elevated. Yes, leverage has increased a little bit since 2010, but it's hard overall in these charts to, even if you look at this COVID-induced spike here in 2020, to say we are at levels that are that sound sort of imminent danger. The very interesting point then, and this is, I think, the true, very important contribution of the paper, is to look at what happened in sort of the minor or the smaller items on the balance sheet. And FE shows us that cash levels have risen. Cash levels relative to debt have been on the rise, both for the median firm and on the aggregate. And then if you put both together, debt over assets and rising cash over debt, and you calculate a net debt over assets ratio, I think this is really the core insight from what FE did. Both for the median firm and on the aggregate, net debt over assets has been on the decline in the US economy pretty constantly, certainly for the median firm, but also in aggregate over the past 20 or 30 years or so. There is a point that I think is important, and FE mentioned it, namely the distribution of aggregate debt and aggregate cash. And I'm showing you here a Lorenz curve, basically for which companies, how is debt, corporate debt, distributed among the distribution of firms. And you see that, you know, it's really the big guys who account for the bulk of debt. So the cumulative share and aggregate debt, even of like the bottom 60% of firms or so, is tiny. When we talk about corporate debt, we talk about the largest 20% of firms, and those firms are the ones where, and this is maybe one point where we need to look more closely in the future at the data. If you look at the right-hand chart, where you have the same Lorenz curve for the distribution of corporate debt, but you also have liquidity over debt, or cash over debt for these firms, you see that's the small firms, as Effie also mentioned, that have raised cash levels so much. But these small firms with cash levels account for a very small proportion of debt. So to the degree that we're worried about aggregate levels of corporate debt, we really need to focus on the big guys. Let me come to my last point, but summarize here in case I don't have time to come to the to run through all the slides. So Effie asks, how worried should we be about corporate debt levels at this moment? And the answer is not so much. The key findings of the paper is that the aggregates, the debt to corporate debt over GDP ratio, masks substantial heterogeneity. Smaller and riskier firms are less leveraged. They have built up cash levels. The interest burden is down. And overall, this, you know, this very clear insight that comes out of Effie's paper meshes really nicely with recent macro work. The corporate debt booms overall are different from household credit booms. They get resolved. We have the institutions, we have reorganization, bankruptcy institution that deal with the aftermath of corporate debt booms. We don't have the same sort of efficient workouts for household debt. And obviously corporate debt is ultimately limited by firm assets, unlike the household side. So these two are different kinds of debt booms, and Effie gives a micro perspective on, even if we zoom in on the corporate balance sheets, we don't have to be so worried. And I want to use my last a couple of minutes to connect Effie's key findings here about the rising share of cash and the decline in net leverage and net debt to a big macro trend that I think all of us think about a lot, and it's hard to escape it in current discussions, namely the rise of savings, the discussion about the savings club. What Effie documents is the rise of cash holding, and I think it's part of a bigger phenomenon, namely the rise of corporate savings. Corporate savings have increased strongly in the past two decades, such that the business sector, that's a fact of life nowadays, the business sector has become a net lender to other sectors of the economy. And if you put one and one together, if the business sector has become a net lender, yes, its financial position has probably improved. So that, again, macro backs up Effie's story here. But also it connects the findings of the paper, connects the rise of corporate savings to a broader question of where all these savings coming from that apparently depress interest rates now for better part of the last decade. And I want to suggest one thing. You might be familiar with the paper by Chen Carver, Boonis and Naiman at JME 2017, where they document that gross saving of the business sector, that's this blue line, has risen quite substantially. This is relative to gross value added of the business sector. So we're going from like below 20 to 25%. So these are in the macro world, meaningful shifts in these aggregates. And I want to connect this to another chart that many of you will know. It's from a paper called The Savings Glut of the Rich by Atif Mian and Amir Sufi and Ludwig Straub, where they show that the top 10% of the US household distribution, the richest 10% of households, have increased their savings quite substantially since the 1980s, while the bottom 90 of the US household distribution have decreased their savings. So they, in their argument, there's been a savings glut of the rich, as more income has accumulated in the hands of the top 10% of households. And these households have very high savings rate. The amount of gross savings supplied by these households has gone up, and as desired investment has not risen to the same extent, interest rates have fallen to clear the market. So now what I want to do is I want to drill down into this 10%, into the savings rate of the top 10%. And I want to show you that a lot of what's going on here, a lot of this rise that Atif and his co-author and Amir and Ludwig document in their paper actually has to do with increasing corporate savings. Now, you might ask, why is that? But before I do this, let me just show you that this is a global phenomenon. So if you combine the US, Europe, and China, you'll see exactly the same phenomenon of rising savings rates of the top 10 of the household distribution and declining savings rate of the bottom 90. And we drill down, and we can do this on the global level, and we do this in a recent paper. If we drill down what's driving this increase in the savings rate of the richest 10% of households, the answer is corporate savings. How is it corporate savings? Well, the richest 10% of households happen to own these corporations that save so much. And you see this here, and in the statistics, in the distribution of national accounts, those corporate savings get attributed to their ultimate owners, which are the rich households. So you see this here, the increase in G3, this is the US, Europe and China together, almost all of the increase in the top 10 savings rate, which you see here, comes from these red bars. And these red bars are retained earnings by corporations that these top 10% of the households own. So I think this is a very nice sort of closes the circle. And also at the end of my discussion, where Effie's paper, while it talks about the corporate debt side, really opens up this very big debate about leverage in a low interest economy. What Effie documented has a lot to do with why interest rates are so low. And so it's an excellent paper that provides essential guidance to policymakers. I think the overall message is don't worry, be happy, at least about corporate debt. Both from a macro and micro perspective, it seems unlikely that corporate debt overhang will become a millstone around the neck of the economy. Effie's paper underscores the rise of corporate cash balance and savings as one of the most striking macro developments. And we urgently need more research to understand this accumulation of safe assets and corporate balance sheets, because it is a little bit of a puzzle why exactly that is happening. Thank you very much, Frederick.
Okay, thanks very much, Moritz. And to answer your question directly, yes, I certainly do recall when we met as you were a graduate student, and I've been delighted to follow your work ever since then. Now, Effie, do you have any, let's start, we're about to turn to questions from the audience in general, but Effie, do you have any specific responses? I didn't think Moritz was challenging in any way, but he certainly opened up interesting dimensions of the topic. So do you have any specific response to Moritz before we turn to audience questions?
And nothing specific, just want to thank Moritz again for an excellent discussion and for the advice that he gave me even before this conference. Thank you very much, Moritz.
Okay, in that case, let's turn first to the audience. And I have here one audience question that's come in, and I encourage others in the audience to participate. This is from Paul Bernard. Question is addressed to you, Effie. Do you have any thoughts on the net leverage for companies owned by private equity firms? These companies are the ones which are serviced most aggressively by the shadow banking sector. That point is anticipating the paper that we're going to see next. They say they also, meaning the companies that are owned by the PE firms, are also likely to pay higher interest rates, given that the private equity owners of these companies are interested in maximizing their value as quickly as possible. They certainly are not borrowing money to park it as cash on the balance sheet. So do you have any view about these private equity, these firms owned by private equity? You might start by clarifying whether they're in your sample or not.
Yeah, so these companies are not in the sample, because that once they are in private equity, they cease to be publicly traded, so they are not included. And I do not know whether they hold a lot of cash. And you know, for, as we heard from the question, it is unlikely that they hold a lot of cash, because that the objective is to maximize value in a short period of time. So I would be surprised if they have low net leverage.
Okay. Now here's a question for me, because one thing that I noticed, Effie, in your pie charts, when you showed us the use of the proceeds of the borrowing, is that you didn't have a wedge of the pie for share repurchases. And so does this mean that these CompuStat firms are not borrowing in order to repurchase shares? But alternatively, if they are, do we have a sense of how big that is? And if it's large, is it something we ought to worry about?
Yes. Yeah, so the reason that it's not there, it's because it's close to zero. Yeah. And you won't be able to show it. There was some hype about firms borrowing money for repurchases, and it really depends on the definition. Some papers say any repurchases while you're borrowing proves that you borrow for repurchases. But that means that I raise debt, let's say I raise $100 worth of debt and I repurchase 1 cent, then they would say those are firms that are repurchasing and borrowing. The magnitude of repurchases do not come close to the magnitude of debt issuances. So it's all a magnitude issue, and at least with my methodology and what you see in the data, repurchases are not being financed. Repurchases are not a significant use of debt in CompuStat firms.
Well, that's comforting, and it takes one issue off of the table for the public policy discussion, I suppose. Here's a broader public policy issue that occurred to me when I was watching what you were presenting. And maybe after you say something, maybe we can engage Moritz on the issue in light of his work on the broader sweep of the use of debt over long periods of time. You were quite explicit that in recent years, at least, companies just don't seem to be borrowing much for the purpose of financing investment. And that's very interesting as a public policy matter, because for years, public policymakers, Federal Reserve, Securities and Exchange Commission, the Congress, everybody has always had the mantra that it's very important to maintain deep and broad debt markets because they serve the economy well, because that's where firms can get capital for investment. And, you know, we have all these stories going back to J.P. Morgan financing, financing Frick and financing Edison and General Electric and all that. And if it's no longer true that what the debt markets are doing is financing firms doing something that we think is valuable to the economy, should we care so much about whether we have debt markets? If somebody comes up with a regulation and the investment bankers say, no, that'll shrink the debt market, should we shrug our shoulders and say, okay, it shrinks the debt market, that's fine? What do you think?
So first, there are some sectors that heavily depend on debt for investments. You know, best example would be airlines. Airlines have been issuing bonds. The bonds are secured by the airplanes that they buy. We call them EETCs. That's a form of securitization. And that type of development for financial development has helped airlines in the US to invest in new aircraft. But airlines are a small sector relative to the rest of the economy. And when you look into the rest of the economy, most of the debt, based on what I've shown you, is not being used for investment. Now, the question that I do not have an answer for, and that relates to Moritz's terrific discussion, is why do firms save so much? And it seems now that firms value saving to some extent even more than investment. So we can view this as, we need to understand why firms want to invest so much, why firms want to save so much. But at least the revealed preferences is that firms are using much more of the dollars that they borrow as for saving as for investment. I'm not sure that I would do anything to hurt credit markets because firms do value the saving, but we just need to understand better why saving is so important for firms now.
Yeah. And just to follow up on that, does this mean that you're sympathetic to your colleague Bob Gordon's view that we now are in an era in which there are no good investments to be made? And the reason firms are valuing saving is, at least according to Bob, there's nothing worthwhile investing in. So why would you invest?
Well, I think that I have probably a mellowed version of that, which is perhaps the opposite. There are huge opportunities for investment. Those are mostly in intangibles. And intangibles are traditionally not being financed with debt. They are financed with retained earning. So we have all of this scale economy and huge economies of scale in firms such as Amazon and Facebook and Google. And the nature of the assets that they invest in are not typically financed with debt. Those are intangibles. So I think that there are great investment opportunities, but those investment opportunities are intangibles and do not require much debt. Yeah.
So I come back to my question from before, that if all of the productivity gains are to be made by investing in intangibles, and intangibles, because they're intangible, are not suitable as collateral for debt, and therefore they're not investment in them, isn't going to be financed by debt. Do we, as a matter of public policy, do we really care whether we have broad and deep debt markets? Why does this matter?
Again, I wish that I could have answered this question, but I think that I do not fully understand. And I think that most of us do not fully understand why firms are holding so much cash. It seems to be important for them. So we need first to understand why it's important for them.
Okay. Moritz, let me see if you have a view, because you've looked at all of this stuff. You know, you have all of this body of work, especially with Alan, where you've looked over century and more. And do you have a view about whether maintaining the vitality of the debt markets is still a high public policy priority?
I have a view on a couple of these issues. I cannot and will not pretend that I can connect all the pieces in my head. Effie and I had great conversations in the run-up to this event about what is going on. Is this a precautionary motive triggered by the crisis, so that companies realized how dependent they were on banks or access to financial markets, and they don't want to go through that potentially near-death experience again, so they built their own buffers? So that would be, emerging markets have precautionary motives to hold treasuries, and sort of the corporates are doing a similar thing since the financial crisis because they don't want to be too dependent on external finance. That's one idea. The other idea is that corporations want to keep a lot of flexibility for acquisitions and want to have control over those and be potentially quick to react. That's one. It still remains puzzling, and I think that connects and the issue of increased corporate savings to these bigger questions about low interest rates, excess savings over investment. I think if we look at the broad macro picture over the last 30 or 40 years, we've seen two things which in my mind are very important and connected, namely the decline in equilibrium interest rates and an explosion in debt. Debt overall has increased, household debt, corporate debt, we've seen these charts. So it's not that there is a dearth of investment. There's like an excess of savings, because at the same time as interest rates have come down, the intermediated amounts have risen. So the only way to get that in a very simple supply demand framework is there's really like been this savings, extra savings glut, this extra supply of savings that has risen so much, so that you can get both the quantities up, namely debt and intermediation, and the price of it down. So I think we're back to trying to understand what's been that secular force behind increased savings. Is it demography? Is it inequality? I think it's less Ben Bernanke savings glut now, because the reserve accumulation has come down and we're still in this very low interest rate world. So I think these are the fascinating questions that we will have to connect, and I'm absolutely on Effie's side. Like, I think we should just go out and ask these CFOs why they're doing it. And I don't think there's a paper that has just done that. And maybe that's a starting point. You know, if you don't have an idea, stop theorizing, just ask people why they're doing what they're doing.
Okay, I see we've got two new questions. We're getting close to the end of our time. We've got two questions that have now come in the chat. So Effie, let's see if you can deal with these somewhat tersely. So James Cox asks the following question, which strikes me as right on target. He says, all this assumes lower rates last forever. Have you projected what impact higher rates would have on macro stability given the higher real leverage?
Yes, so absolutely. Absolutely. If, you know, things can turn their course if interest rates go up. Although I would expect that if interest rates go up, many firms that have excess cash would use the excess cash to pay their debts. So, you know, it's not that if you think that the equilibrium outcome of rising interest rates are we going to be at the same debt levels and interest rates would go up, you know, we have a problem. But if you think about a more nuanced equilibrium in which, as a response to a rise in interest rates, firms would save less, and, you know, use the cash holdings to repay some of the debt, we may end up in a lower leverage. Now, the transition will be difficult, but is this necessarily going to be a disaster? I'm not sure.
Great. Okay, and the last question we're going to have time for is one from Mark Carey, who asked the following question. He says, the share of rated corporate debt that is below investment grade is now higher than ever. Most defaults are by junk-rated companies. this does not square with the don't worry conclusion. Is it because most junk debt is now issued by private equity sponsored firms, which are mostly not in your data set? So what do you think about, in effect, he's asking, how are you contrasting, or how do you think about the connection between your somewhat comfortable view and the prevalence of junk rated bonds?
I mean, the comfortable view, and I think that even more, if I would speak for Moritz, but he can correct me, even his, you know, some level of comfortable view doesn't say that there won't be difficulties. It just says that, you know, on average, when you look back and when you look into what you have, the turbulence is not going to be very high. You know, there is going to be some turbulence, but the damage to the economy is not going to be that severe. Now, as for Mark's question, the answer is very simple. 80% of those who issue bonds in the market are, about 80% are rated as investment grade. And he is referring to the firms that are borrowing from what we call delivered loans. Some of them are in my sample, some of them are not. Those tend to be smaller firms. And as smaller firms, you know, those firms may end up in bankruptcy and they will be reorganized. But to tell you that they would necessarily have a macro effect on the real economy, I don't think so.
Okay. So I want to thank, we're at the conclusion of our time for the first session. So I thank Effie very much for his paper and his presentation. I thank Moritz for his discussion. And I thank the three people who submitted very good, I thought, questions. We're now going to take a break for 15 minutes and we will reconvene at 11:35. That's 11:35 for the next session. And I hope everybody comes back to join us. Thank you very much. Welcome back, everybody. We're now ready to move on to the second paper, where the focus is not on the macroeconomics side of what the Federal Reserve is normally interested in, but the regulation side. And our paper is by Ishel Erel from Ohio State. So Ishel, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this very important conference. Today, I'm talking about evolution of debt financing towards less regulated financial intermediaries. And I will start with the extent of non-bank or less regulated lending in the loan and bond markets in the US. I will speak about the characteristics, and then I will talk about vulnerabilities of these non-banks and vulnerabilities of these non-banks are creating vulnerabilities for the system. And then I will end with a discussion of COVID-19 as an experiment, this COVID-19 shock. Obviously, this topic is a huge topic, and I cannot cover everything that I have in the paper. So all references and more are in the paper, and I would encourage you to look at the paper if you're interested in these topics in general. So I will start with the loan market and then move to the bond market. And when I talk about the loans, I will start with the smallest loans and go to the largest loans later. So about the small loans by banks first, on the graph, you see small loans by medium and large banks in the US. This is the CRA data. And you see that we see a significant drop after the Great Recession in small loans by medium and large banks. And this continued till about 2010. And then we have a reversal. But the important point is that we never reached back to the pre-crisis levels. And this credit gap in small business lending has been discussed in a couple of papers. And Victoria is an author of one of those papers. And there's also another paper by Chan, Hansen, and Stein showing that this change post-crisis is the most significant for the largest four banks. And importantly for us today, the gap is partially filled by non-banks between 2010 and 2014. Goldman and Schnabel provide us some unique data, unique loan level data from UCC, and discussing similar topics. They show that the small business lending by banks decreased significantly post Great recession till about 2010 again. And this decline happened also for non-banks, namely finance companies. As you see on their figure one that I included on my slide, finance companies were larger lenders in this space even before the crisis or during the crisis. And their share dropped as well. But importantly, the increase in their share is sharper post 2020. And perhaps more importantly, fintech lenders joined them as well. And if we look at the share of finance companies and fintech lenders in 2016, we see that their share increased to 56%. Their data is unique. I should also note that they cover small loans secured by non-real estate collateral, and the data is coming from the UCC. They also provide some evidence that there is some substitution for bank lending. Non-bank share increases in counties with a larger share of bank lending pre-crisis. Now that I talk about small business lending, of course, I need to mention digital lending or lending platforms. We see a large growth in lending to small businesses by digital lenders pre-crisis. Why? The survey evidence shows that the main reason is that they are denied by other lenders, especially by banks. But they also enjoy faster turnaround and online accessibility, as Karen Mills and co-authors show. So they do not want to spend 25 hours filling out forms for banks, and they really enjoy the faster turnout provided by digital lenders. We have some evidence that they replace hard information-based lending, but not necessarily so for soft information-based lending. Very often these digital lenders partner with banks, online banks especially. And an open question in this market is that whether we are concerned whether they are they can stay independent as unregulated lenders, especially in economic downturns, especially with the recent evidence that we saw in this market, that they many important players in this market engaged in mergers with online lenders. For example, American Express acquired Cabbage, and Lending Club merged with Radius Bank recently. Okay, moving to the non-bank lending to mid-size firms. I have a paper with Sergey Chernenko and Robert Prinmeyer where we provide unique hand-collected data on direct loans to publicly traded middle market firms. And the evidence is, the data is from 2010 to 2015. I just want to emphasize that these are loans that are not syndicated. These are loans where the lenders are directly negotiating with the borrower. In other words, these are direct loans. We were very surprised to see that one third of direct loans to the public middle market firms, and these are the typical Compustat firms, are extended by non-bank financial institutions in this time period. And who are the important players? Finance companies, private equity firms, and hedge funds are the top three lenders. But we also see lending by investment banks, investment managers, insurance companies, BDCs, and mutual funds. And this is a worldwide phenomenon, I should say. Pricken, in their 2019 Global Private Debt Report, shows that global assets under management of private debt funds, again, these are like private equity funds concentrating on unsyndicated direct loans, the number has grown to almost $900 billion in 2019. Why? They are simply reaching for yield. In our paper, we also provide evidence, data on the characteristics of non-bank borrowers and their loans. Non-bank borrowers are on average riskier with lower, even negative profitability. As you see on the slide, the fraction or the probability of non-bank lending jumps when we move from positive EBITDA to negative EBITDA. A middle market firm with a small negative EBITDA is 34% more likely to borrow from a non-bank compared to a non-bank firm with a small positive EBITDA. It's important to know that although the probability, unconditional probability of bankruptcy is about 8% larger for non-bank borrowers, when we control for loan and borrower characteristics, the probability drops to an insignificant number. Despite that, non-banks charge on average about 170 basis points more to middle market firms when they lend directly to them. And this number increases to 400 or 500 basis points when we talk about asset managers. They are less likely to include covenants in their contracts, and these loans are more likely to be unsecured. They are more innovative in their loan contracts. For example, they can include warrants in them. What about the syndicated loan market? So when we look at the syndicated loan market, especially the leveraged term loans, because these are the loans that institutional investors, non-banks, have been traditionally participating. And my discussant wrote papers on this topic. As she argued, already in 2006, we had about 250 institutional investors participating in these loans. And on the graphs, especially on the right, the one on the right, you see the percent of non-bank lenders in leveraged term loans between 1991 and 2021. We see an increase leading to the financial crisis and then a slight drop, but then an increase again. And unlike during the financial crisis, the participation is high in 2020 and especially 2021 so far, with over 80% of the leveraged term loans involving a non-bank lender. So I don't know the details of these lenders, but a paper by Iranian co-authors speak a lot about the details of these lenders. They show that CLOs became the largest non-bank investor by 2002, but hedge funds, private equity firms, and loan mutual funds caught up in 2014. These non-banks are even more important in the secondary market, and their market volume has been doubled in the last 20 years and has been increasing even further. So unlike in the case of middle market firms, institutional demand leads to lower spreads, reducing the syndication completion time or increasing the likelihood of securitization. But like in the case of mid-sized firms, co-light syndicated loans are more associated with non-bank lending. So why am I talking about this shift? Why is this shift to non-bank lending important? Because it's important because I'm talking about a shift from regulated lenders to unregulated or lightly regulated ones. Of course, this shift creates concerns on data ownership, privacy and security, possible fraudulent lending. I'm talking about a shift from lenders with stable funding to lenders subject to runs, and we will talk a lot about this later. Non-bank lending is concentrated in riskier loans, as I just showed you. You might argue that this is serving the underserved by banks, but the research already showed that, research also showed that these lenders extract some rents from borrowers as these borrowers cannot borrow from elsewhere. And these lenders are likely to exit if the creditworthiness of the borrower improves because they are looking for higher yields. And because non-banks partially, at least partially, finance these loans by loans that they extend to the borrowers by loans from regulated banks, we are also concerned about interconnections with the regulated financial institutions. Okay, speaking of regulation, what's the role of bank regulation in all this? I would argue that bank regulation drives non-bank loans. It's an important factor. In my paper on middle market firms and non-bank lending, we show that lending to negative EBITDA firms is due to cash flow loans deemed substandard by the regulator, the OCC. There's also some evidence that interagency guidance on leveraged lending shifted leveraged lending to non-banks. It reached its aim, reducing the leveraged lending by banks, but it shifted this lending to non-banks. There is very strong evidence on the effect of capital requirements. Iranian and co-authors show that increase in tier one capital requirements for banks contributed to the increase in non-bank participation in syndicated loans. Stress tests, last but not least, they have reduced riskier small business lending as aimed for by large banks. But there is a strong evidence that non-banks filled in the gap. And some of these non-banks are BDCs, as shown by this paper by Davidook and co-authors. Okay, what about the corporate bond market, which is the primary source of external funding for non-financial firms? We see a huge change in the landscape of institutional holders in this market as well. And this is partly due to the rapid development of the asset management industry. With that, we have about share of mutual funds in the bonds market, increasing from 5% in 1990 to about 35% in 2020. And here on this figure, you see the participation of various institutional investors in the US bond market. The color that you should pay attention to is the red color, which is what I just talked about, an increase from 5% of share for mutual funds to about 35% as share in 2020. Of course, insurance companies are very important players in the bond market. Actually, with the pension funds, they were the dominant investors in the bond markets before 1990s. And their shares started dropping since then. We see some increase after 2010, but their share is about 30% now. So thinking about these two largest bond investors, we have to consider their incentives for reaching for yield. Insurance companies, for example, prefer higher yielding instruments within risk weights, the so-called regulatory capital arbitrage. We also see lately, this is small, but a shift in focus towards CLOs with higher yields after a regulatory capital change. Another note on the role of regulation here. We also see in the mutual fund industry reaching for yield to generate higher returns and attract more inflows to their funds. So overall, all these reaching for yield incentives have shifted the overall supply of funds towards riskier borrowers and securities in this market. We see a huge increase in the issuances of bonds. I don't have time to talk about that, but I want to emphasize the characteristics of bonds that insurance companies versus mutual funds invest in. They complement each other, actually. Insurance companies mostly prefer investment-grade bonds, while mutual funds mostly prefer, as you know, high-yield bonds. And we see a huge increase in both types of bonds in the last decade. And investment grade bond market is much larger in size. But we see an important shift in this market towards triple B rated bonds, which is the lowest rating for an investment grade bond. Why am I concerned about this? Because this shift creates concerns about fallen angels. Insurance companies, for example, sell downgraded bonds due to capital requirements when they are facing fallen angels. And passively managed mutual funds and ETFs would have period-determined investment mandate restrictions that would consider these changes as well. Okay. Credit risk, especially in high-yield borrowing, has increasingly been held by non-banks rather than banks. Why am I concerned about this? Because this might have huge financial stability implications. And these implications speak to the fragility, funding fragility of non-banks, leading to funding fragility for non-financial firms with non-banks as lenders. Non-banks are subject to runs when investors become concerned about the entity's solvency. Many papers talk about this, and this fact could lead to fire sales. We have some evidence of the problems that this fact created during the Great Recession, during the 2008 financial crisis, from Irani paper, Irani et al. 2021 paper. Non-bank participation share in syndicated loans had a negative effect on credit availability around that time. And we saw a large downward pressure on secondary market prices, and borrowers importantly could not substitute to other syndicated loans. Jeremy Stein, when he was the governor of the Federal Reserve System, he gave this famous speech in 2013, where he emphasized the surge in junk bond issuance and leveraged loans. He also noted that it's important to understand what fraction is financed by funds fragile to the runs. So when I talk about the fragility, of course, I need to also consider the growth in bond mutual funds subject to these runs. As you see on the figure, we see a very large growth after 2008 in the bond holdings of mutual funds and ETFs also. For these funds, secondary bond markets are, I should emphasize that secondary market for these bond mutual funds, they are highly illiquid. And there is a recent IMF report also emphasizing that. And research has shown that their outflows are more sensitive to recent performance compared to other funds. This is very important. And perhaps most importantly, redemption price does not adjust for trading costs for illiquid securities. That's why literature extensively talked about the first mover advantage and cascade of redemptions problems with respect to these bond funds. Okay, why should we care about all this? Because these fragilities affect mutual funds, funds primary markets and also secondary markets. So mutual fund flows directly affect primary bond markets. And fire sales in the secondary market would put downward pressure on market prices and increase the return volatility. Of course, all these would lead directly and indirectly higher issuance costs, decreases in the probability of bond issuance, affecting the corporate borrowing of non-financial firms, which we do care a lot about. Because we don't want to have an underinvestment problem, or we don't want these non-financial firms to be pushed to search for alternative sources of funding. I don't have much time to talk about the interconnectedness in this market, but here's a figure from the Financial Stability Board as of March, from their report on March 2020. As you see, the figure is very complex with all these banks and non-banks interconnected with each other. So all this growth in non-bank lending, of course, because of these interconnections, is creating issues for banks as well. So we see these trends in non-bank lending leading to the COVID-19 shock that I just talked about, making the market liquidities making the market liquidity even more central to the financial stability. And now in my last 4 minutes or so, I will provide some evidence from COVID-19 shock just to see how non-banks and banks responded. I will start with the banks. Banks provided liquidity to customers, unlike during the 2008 financial crisis. They did an excellent job. They faced the largest increase in the takedowns under existing credit lines ever observed in the last 3 weeks of March 2020. I'm talking about a weekly growth in demand for bank C&I loans that's 50 times larger than the last 50 years. And of course, unprecedented inflow of deposits helped them. And we see this inflow of flight to safety in down cycles. But our authors, Levine and co-authors, argue that this inflow, in this case, might be more due to more anxiety about future income loss leading to more savings. So starting with the smallest loans, let's talk about non-bank lenders. We see the collapse of fintech lending in March 2020, driven by small business loans. As you see on these figures from S&P, overall, the market did well in 2020. But if you look at the figure in the bottom, you see the collapse in March 2020. And Ben David and co-authors show that this was due to funding fragility affecting their lending. However, I should also emphasize that I have a paper co-authored with Jack Liberson where we show that non-banks' participation in the Paycheck Protection Program later in April to August was very important because they ended up serving the underserved by commercial banks. Leveraged loans, no issuance in March 2020, but the average riskiness was very high. Average debt to EBITDA ratio was about 6.41% in quarter two of 2020. The recovery was quick in terms of the issuance volume. As I showed you before, over 80% of leveraged term loans had non-bank participation already in from the data that we have for 2021. Okay, I talked a lot about the fragility of bond mutual funds. Here on the figure, you see this fragility, the evidence for this fragility speaking to the net inflows in March of 2020. Over 200 billion of net outflows from bond mutual funds in March of 2020. Asset redemptions from these funds started far earlier. This, of course, increased the trading volume tremendously. Yield spreads on investment grade and high yield bonds tripled relative to mid-February. And it's important to note that regulation-driven constraints on the supply of liquidity with respect to the dealers in this market contributed to this problem. Fed intervened successfully, and then the bond issuance recovered very quickly. My time is almost up. Let me conclude by saying that hopefully I convince you that the extent of non-bank lending is large and growing fast with reaching for yield incentives. And this substitution into non-banks is an unintended consequence of financial regulation for banks and other more regulated institutions. We tested the fragility of non-bank subject to runs during COVID-19. Fed intervention was an effective financial stability tool. But what can we do other than the Fed intervention? About the runs, research has proposed swing pricing schemes. About the fire sales, Paris market-to-market accounting rules applying to both sides of the balance sheet. And on the capital requirements, we have been talking a lot about macroprudential regulation, similar capital requirements for all players in this market. Thank you so much. My time is up, and I'm looking forward to the discussion and the questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Ishelle. And our discussant is Victoria Ivashina from the Harvard Business School.
Thank you very much, Ben. And let me see if this is shared. Ben, can you give me a thumbs up if you can see my slides? Awesome. All right. Thank you to Ben and to the organizers for inviting me to discuss this paper. I just want to reiterate a couple of high-level points that Ishal was trying to make, and I would summarize it in the following way. One is the fact that the growth of credit that we have seen after the financial crisis was driven by a wide range of institutional investors. Second is that most of these institutional investors are not regulated. And ultimately, there are reasons for concerns about fragility of this individual institutional pockets. And Ishal gave some examples of that. So I will try to think about whether we can crystallize these views about what is driving it and to what degree we should be concerned beyond just understanding that there are many, many institutional investors and they might be outside of the scope of tools that we have. So my agenda here is the following. One is to kind of try to re-examine the topology of the non-bank lenders. If you were following, Michelle looked at smallest to largest, right? We started with platforms and small business lending all the way to the leveraged loan market. Relatedly, we'll think about what drives their growth. The view in the presentation is that it's driven by regulation, and that's certainly a factor, but there are other things to think about. And then the most important question of the day is, should we be worried about it, the implications for fragility, and ultimately projecting these implications for fragility into what we have seen in 2020. So on the first point, one view that is expressed in the paper, it's kind of this big blanket, and it's more emphasizing the fact that these are non-bank institutions. And I think that if you're going to think about deeper about fragility, I mean, the realization that these are a wide range of different institutional investors with different balance sheet constraints, with different incentives, is already very important. But can we do better? Can we organize our thoughts a little bit better about that? So notice that we are talking about all type of credit here. That includes consumer credit and non-financial corporate credit. So there is also, the size does matter here. And this is a framework that Ishal had in her presentation, but there is a little bit more than that. So let's put the large and medium, which is where leveraged loan market is, all the way to the left, and go to medium and small firms. That's where I would say the corporate credit ends. Then we enter into very small firms where it's equivalent to lending to people. A lot of due diligence, monitoring, it's all done at the personal level ultimately, and finally, personal credit. Now, traditionally, we also think about the following structure in credit, right? So first, there is asset-based, which was a very different type of risk, right? If you're thinking about credit risk. And then we have secured and unsecured. Okay, so that's the structure, and it kind of appears in each one of those segments. And credit markets are heavily segmented, right? So those are, I would say, that the matrix, if I would start thinking about the credit markets overall, that would be the grid in which I would be thinking about the market. Now let's populate this structure with segments that have been growing. And this is what we see. Post 2008, if you look at the largest end of it, we have leveraged loan market that has experienced very high growth and high yield bonds. Private debt, that's primarily middle, medium and small firms. And we have the smallest firms and personal credit dominated by fintech. So those are the big pockets of growth in credit. Of course, everything has grown post 2008, but this is abnormal levels of growth for that market. Now let's figure out why is it that they're growing, right? So with this structure in mind, I think that there is a little bit more than regulation going on here. Private debt is a very good candidate. So the medium to small firms, that's a great candidate for thinking about regulation on the margin. At the very least, regulation played a significant role to jumpstart that market, right? Whether if we dial up regulation, dial down the regulation, the private debt would disappear. That I think is an interesting question, and I would argue that it wouldn't. But regardless, regulation is a good explanation for why medium to small firms' credit has grown. It is not a very good explanation otherwise. In fact, we've seen the leveraged loan market and high yield bond market having cycles way ahead of the ones that we observe over the past decade. So I think that the low rate interest environment is much bigger explanation there for understanding what drives the growth of those pockets. And it was very much in line with the evidence that Ishel presented for example, insurance companies, mutual funds, and several others, right? On the other end, it's not surprising that this is where fintech is kind of concentrated, right? And by the way, there is a very nice, there are several attempts. One thing that we're missing in fintech is within fintech trying to impose a structure of what fintech represents, right? And so there is a nice attempt by Angenta Core, to my knowledge, this is the best effort today, of trying to consolidate thoughts about how to think about the fintech in this broader financial intermediation. But clearly the data and analytics revolution is probably the major factor in driving all the fintech applications. And how do we think about personal credit? Now, in each one of those segments, so now kind of moving towards the fragility, in each one of those segments, there is actually layers. And once we start thinking about fragility, this is where we need to think about a little bit more specifically about what might underpin this fragility. Just as an illustration, here I'm diving into non-bank corporate space. Now, on the right, collateralized loan obligation, loan mutual fund, that's those are the layers within the syndicated loan market or leveraged loan market, because not all syndicated loan market is leveraged loan market, right? Now, let's zoom on the direct lending. And this is where you see business and development companies on the bottom. And then you see a range of direct lenders, mezzanine, special situations, distress, et cetera, et cetera. This is a space that is, she mentioned the number of close to $1 trillion, $900 billion, which is a segment that has grown from very small size in 2008 all the way to this nearly $1 trillion that is today. So this is just to illustrate you this. Once you zoom on the structure, then within each one of them, there are layers of different financial intermediaries that coexist with each other, right? And this might be relevant to think about when you think about financial fragility. So in the paper, getting to the point of financial fragility, the paper lays out the following structure. So the first one, which is the textbook of looking for financial fragility, is thinking about funding structure and short-term or runnable. Definitely, yes, right? With a caveat that a lot of institutions that I just have shown you don't have those pressures. But some of them do. And for example, in the large cap mutual funds, like of course, are runnable institutions, and this was one prominent example in the paper. Now, the second point that the paper highlights is, so first, let's look for funding fragility. Second, let's look for the amplification mechanisms. And one such amplification mechanism is interconnection with banks. And second is, specifically speaking to the bond market, is the dealer's balance sheet, which of course ties with the restrictions, regulatory restrictions for banks to intermediate bond market. So to that, I would add the following that is, to me, was missing in the paper. In amplification mechanisms, of course, it didn't escape anybody that during the pandemic crisis, financial crisis, there have been quite a big conversation about consequences of high leverage. There are a couple of topics that were highlighted most prominently. There was a concern that many defaults will lead to amplification of the initial negative shocks. Now, turning to the side of financial intermediaries, which is the topic of this paper, I think that the missing gap in the literature here, the underdeveloped gap in the literature, is related to the fact that the defaults were real concern. And yes, the government intervention helped, but apologies, I don't think I see warnings about my time, but I'll assume I still have time. Just the fact that they avoided the amplification of the crisis in March doesn't mean that this was not a relevant concern, right? And so with this in mind, we probably want to understand all those different intermediaries that we had outlined. Are they patient? Are they able to hold their positions through negative shocks? Do they mark to market? And therefore, do they fire sale? Can they renegotiate? Do they have capacity to deal with the distress or the institutions that would not be able to deal with the stress once the asset entered the situation? So you see how there are several other elements that we are concerned about in this that relate to the nature of this financial intermediaries. And just going back to this outline that I provided, just as an example, let's zoom on this institutions from the funding perspective, right? And so this team of funding is highlighted in the paper. So for example, if you look at the CLOs, we know the CLO market can freeze, and it did freeze in the past twice, but it's a not runnable structure. They're funded with long-term bonds and not marked to market. Shifting to the middle market, if you look at the fund structure, they don't freeze, they actually sit on the dry powder when the negative shock hits, nor they run because they're long-term funding structures. If you look at the BDC, they can freeze, but they don't run. That's a publicly traded structure. So that leaves us in the large cap with a low mutual funds, which is heavily emphasized in this paper. And it's not surprising that much of the literature about where the funding fragility sits is sitting with a low mutual fund. But that misses the point that each one of their pockets is not necessarily well positioned to deal with the distress. Furthermore, there are actually another point that is missing in the paper in its outline, is that they all face constraints. And specifically for the CLOs, this is something that's been voiced in 2020 and was also in Shohini Kundu's job market paper, that CLO structures are very sensitive to several market shifts. In particular, something that I've done is showing that they are very sensitive to downgrades. And once they face significant downgrades, they do not have capacity to renegotiate. And that kind of bounces back to the companies and amplifies the distress which they might be suffering. So the point that I was trying to make here from the fund, so first of all, the structure of the different, of the broader market for leverage. Second is how do we think about this in a broader structure about funding pressures? And third is the fact that FIBA might be interested beyond the funding pressures. It's not only through the liability structures that this can become an amplifying effect. There was a suggestion in the paper, it came out a little bit less in the presentation, about a benign synergy between the banking sector and this non-regulated and non-regulated segment. Banks sit on deposits. We know very well from the literature that when negative shocks hit, there is actually an inflow of deposits. So perhaps there is this natural synergy where non-bank lenders deal with issue all this credit. And then when the shock hits, they sell it back to the banking sector at some discounted value effectively. All right. Well, I just don't see how that interesting idea. I don't see how this possibly can work. Not to mention, I don't see how this could be a good idea. So specifically, if you look at this outline, we have two ends, right? One of them is the one driven by reaching for yield is extremely high risk. And from 2008, we know that banks, even in that regulatory framework, if anything, banks were selling heavily all kinds of assets that looked high yield. On the other end, we have non-standard methodologies for thinking about credit risk and processing it and following it. And that is just requires a high level of sophistication that I think that, again, we don't want it put back on the bank. So that point is interesting, but in my view is not realistic and not desirable. Now, an interesting point suggestion in the paper is, however, yes, there could be other hidden ways for the bank to get in, to be involved. This passing the interconnectedness, the point about interconnectedness that the Schill raised. And here I do think that there is a little bit lack of research in understanding what role banks play. As a specific example, in collateralized loan obligations, each collateralized loan obligation structure is backed by warehousing. And through the ramp up period, there is substantial level of risks that banks are exposed to. This is just one example, but I think that there is a broader issue about what role banks play backing up creation of these operations and providing leverage to these institutions. As a conclusion, I will just speak to 2020. Schill did a great job highlighting some of the effects that were documented in 2020, specifically the run on the mutual funds mutual funds that were investing in leveraged loans as well as in high yield bonds. That's an important observation. But I think that I want to reiterate my earlier point about that non-bank lenders, there are several other things that we want to understand about them, because the amplification of the effect not only comes from liability, it also comes from how are they positioned and are they capable, are they unconstrained to deal with distressed assets and over which horizon. So this is where I think that we don't understand very much. And I would be very cautious to balance the point from the first presentation about don't worry, be happy. I think that both Cecile and I are somewhat in a different camp here. I do think that it's fantastic that 2020 shock was moderated through the government intervention. But at the same time, we spend a lot of time thinking about moral hazard in rescuing banks. Effectively, there was implicit bailout on a lot of institutional investors. And one question is to what degree the government intervention also facilitated moral hazard in this highly levered economy. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Victoria. So let's go back to Ishel. Ishel, let's begin with and giving you an opportunity to respond to what Victoria has said. And let me now remind our audience participation that the lines are open for questions and we'll be accumulating those. But Ishel, I'll start with you.
Thank you, man. And thank you, Victoria, for this excellent discussion. You know, all points are very well taken. I mean, this is a huge and very important topic. So I'm very glad that we agree on this. But I also agree with you that, you know, I perhaps overemphasize the role of regulation and there are other factors. I mean, I tried to touch on low interest rates and reaching for yield incentives. Data and analytics revolution is an interesting one, right? Like we should think about why banks don't invest in this on this like enough, right? Like, could there be an effect of regulation there as well, right? Like, you know, if they really see the small business lending is a good market for themselves, I think they could have invested in this. In this revolution as well. Heterogeneity among lenders is very important. The data is always an issue and, you know, we all have been working to, on that. And thinking about, you know, defaults in this high yield investment market, you know, are they patients or are they marketing to market? These are all excellent points. And hopefully research will kind of address these points going forward. You know, one thing that I try to emphasize in the smallest loans, like it was very interesting to see that like there was a collapse in March of 2020 by lending platforms, you know, their lending really dropped, like, you know, and this was due to their as argued by Ben David and others, like due to their financial fragility. So whether we can extend this to kind of larger lenders is an open question, I think. Thank you.
Okay, I don't see any questions yet in the chat. And so let me follow up with one on my own that I think Victoria picked up on as well. What do we think is the probability that if something goes wrong, the government is going to have to bail all these people out? And because even though in principle, they're apart from the banks, which we know are always bailed out, their liabilities are held in the banks anyway. I'm reminded of what happened in Japan years ago. You see you nodding, so you're no doubt familiar with this. I can't remember the name of these Japanese institutions. You may remember, but the story in Japan was, oh, no, don't worry. All these loans that are risky are held by the whatevers. And then if you asked, yes, but who is financing the whatevers? The answer is, oh, well, it's the banks. Well, and of course, in the end, the whole thing had to get bailed out. What is the probability that next time something goes seriously wrong, that's exactly where we're going to be?
You know, it's really hard to say something certain about this, but the probability to me is very high, especially after what we experienced in the 2008 financial crisis, right? And there we didn't even have these high numbers. I mean, since then, the role of non-banks in the credit markets has been increasing a lot. You know, I talk about 1/3 of middle market firms borrowing from non-banks directly, right? This is a very large number. And with all these interconnections with the banks, you know, I see the probability of intervention, you know, to be very high. I don't know, Victoria, what do you think?
I think the mechanism would be slightly different. So the specific questions that Ben is asking, so he's tracing parallel with Japan, and he's saying, at the end of the day, this was all on the surface, but underneath it was all funded by the banks. And that's it. So therefore it was just to some degree labeling. I don't think it's the case here. We do know how the structures are funded, and we know that banks play a role, but as a short-term stop. So if you want to ask that question, the question is, at any given point in time, how big is that exposure? But we know for a fact that, for example, 900 billion of private debt is not funded by bank. At any given point in time, they're playing short-term role at different stages, especially at the beginning. So in that sense, I don't think that it's as simple as, oh, it's actually all bank funded. But I do think that there is a different channel for that. And that's the one that I was trying to highlight in my presentation, in that, ultimately, there's a reason. I mean, banks play an important amplifying role. But if you think about companies, it's companies that we wanted to rescue in 2020, right? So at that point, this non-bank institutions, because I'm trying to save the economy. And if these institutions are not capable to refinance it, to renegotiate it, to wait, then I don't have many choices. So I think that second channel is more relevant than that going through the bank balance sheet.
Definitely. I totally agree with that. And that's why I said, like, you know, we see this 1/3 of like non-bank lending coming from, middle market firms funding coming from non-banks, and you know, you know, whether they are connected with banks or not, you know, when we cut funding to them, they will be in trouble, right? Like, and same for small business lending. As you showed in your paper, we see a huge credit gap after the financial crisis, because generally large or medium-sized banks see these businesses peripheral to their main business. So they're being cutting big time, you know, on the small business lending side, and then non-banks are filling in this gap. So if then that means that if non-banks are in trouble, then these small businesses will have, you know, funding issues, and same for mid-sized businesses as well.
Okay, we have a couple of questions now coming in the chat. So let me come to the first one. Here's a question from James Cox. Question is, the Federal Reserve has assumed the position of lender of last resort, buying corporate debt as tested in April 2020. With this increased non-bank fragility that we're talking about here, in the next recession, who ends up holding the bag? Are we assuming the Federal Reserve has infinite appetite for either junk bonds or foreign angels? Are there, well, here's a question you can construe differently. Mr. Cox asks, are there no consequences to financialization? Well, surely there are consequences, but I would interpret the question as, what are the most significant consequences you think we're facing?
Yeah, that's a very good point. You know, that's what I tried to end with, right? Like, you know, so this intervention was very successful. But I think the question is, what can we do without, you know, requiring an intervention by the Fed, right? You know, about these fragilities. And as Victoria and the person who's asking the question emphasized, this, you know, intervention perhaps even like created more fragility now. People talked about, for example, in case of bond funds, swing pricing, and it seems to be helping, according to the IMF report around the world. You know, on the insurance companies, as I said, like, you know, marking to market on both sides of the balance sheet has been discussed, or like in general macroprudential regulation for capital requirements. So I think we should just like think hard about, you know, what to do, kind of to help the system without requiring the Fed intervention.
Okay, here's another more specific question about regulation. Let me find it here. This is from Paul Bernard. And looking at his question, then I'm going to have a follow-up with my own. Paul Bernard asks, what regulatory or market structure changes would the speakers suggest given the larger presence of debt mutual funds with all of their issues? Ishel, you documented the increasing role of these bond funds. And then there's goes on to address something about money market funds and their problem. But turning to the bond funds that you were emphasizing, Ishel, are there regulatory or market structure changes that you would recommend that focus in particular on the bond funds?
Yeah, I think the question came before I just talked about the swing pricing. So that's the, I think, to my knowledge, that's what the research has been proposing. So the problem there is that there is a first mover advantage and a cascade of redemptions. And when you do the redemptions, you know, because these are open-ended funds, the illiquidity of the asset side, investment side, is not considered. Swing pricing that would consider the costs of those liquidations has been proposed, and it has been used in other parts of the world. And this IMF report that I just mentioned showed that in countries where they use the swing pricing, they did better during the COVID-19 shock.
And as I'm guessing you're aware, the Securities and Exchange Commission has recently proposed, and I think, I don't know where they are in implementing it, a new set of liquidity requirements for these mutual funds. And I don't know whether you would consider that a way of addressing the first mover advantage, that if the idea is if there's an incipient run on these funds, then to the extent that they're carrying more assets that are liquid, unlike the highly illiquid assets that are their core holdings, then they have some cushion for redeeming out whoever is the first mover. And then that happens without triggering fire sales in illiquid markets. And then maybe other share owners don't worry so much about getting out. So do you have a view of the new SEC initiative in this direction?
Certainly it would help, but also I want to emphasize that the literature has looked at it. For example, there is a paper by Adi Sundaram and Sergey Chernenko, like looking at the liquidity management of these funds. And, you know, they've been successful. But I think the consensus in the literature is that it has not been enough. I don't know, setting the boundaries would be important, I guess. But to my knowledge, people have been, that's why people, because liquidity management has not been effective enough, has been pushing for the swing pricing.
So maybe that means the SEC regulation is a good idea, but maybe ought to be ramped up in terms of the floors that they are considering?
Yes, definitely. That's what the research shows, I think.
Yeah, I think the funds that I am aware of are do things like look at the maximum daily redemptions over a week or so that they've experienced in various market circumstances, and then try to hold liquid assets to meet that. But of course, there's a kind of negative incentive here, because surely these liquid assets on average bear very low returns, and therefore any fund that loads up on liquid assets is then penalizing its return to the share owners, and therefore looks uncompetitive compared to the others. So is there a way to cut through that perverse incentive?
Regulation.
Regulation would help, but I don't know whether overdoing will have a negative effect, so that's the issue, right?
And if I may,
Victoria, go ahead. Yes, please.
Yeah, so to earlier point about whether there is a magical level of liquidity that would somehow solve this problem, I think it has to be tied to a view that there is some sort of composition of the investors in the mutual fund, that this run stops after a certain point. And I'm not aware of that view. And so therefore it's not clear to me how more liquidity is always better. But then, as you said, we run into the separate problem in that I invest in a high yield mutual funds because I want the yield. And if a mutual fund does not deliver it for me, I will start investing in different asset class. And so then we just solve problem here and people run into a different part. And then we have another conference talking about reaching for yield elsewhere.
Okay, we have another question in the chat. This one comes from Dennis O'Brien, who asks, do you feel that there is more or less clarity in regard to the risk associated with non-banks relative to the last financial crisis? So in effect, he's asking, have we made any progress in the last, 13 years? He said, last time, it was not clear who the bag holders were until the fourth or fifth inning of the correction in the cycle. So Ishel, what do you think? Are we in a better place than we were 13 years ago?
Yes, of course, the research helps, right? Now we understand better, you know, after all our efforts in data collection and writing these papers, like, you know, the extent of this non-bank lending and the details of it. As Victoria rightfully pointed out, you know, we need even like more details on the heterogeneity. I think we know a lot more about them, but we need even more research on non-bank lending to understand even more, I think, going forward. But everybody is interested in this topic. I mean, like, you know, this conference speaks to it, right? Like, you know, so. And the practitioners are interested in this topic. I think it's good to see all this interest, and this will create even like more information. And it's also important to note that, the structure and the characteristics of this lending has been changing. And I tried to touch on that, and Victoria did so as well. So it's ever evolving.
When the practitioners exhibit an interest in the research, are they normally a force, a positive force or a negative force?
I always see, you know, any force towards research as a positive force, right? Like, you know, so, I mean, they are interested in understanding this more, and it creates more research as well.
Okay. Now, here's a question that may or may not be fair that comes in from James Cox. He asks, how do we reconcile, or can we, the cash holdings result from the first paper about how much cash firms or non-financial firms are holding with the fragility that we're talking about here? What should we take away from the fact that on the one side we see all these debt markets that look fragile, and on the other side we just see so many companies swamped on the asset side of their balance sheet with liquid assets? Is one a help for the other, or is this a situation in which you can't net it, because if Ben has a lot of debts that go bad and Ishel has a lot of assets, Ishel's assets just aren't there to help Ben pay his debts. So.
Yeah, Victoria wants to talk. Let me be very quick. So this hoarding for cash incentives are there. I mean, and it is, to my knowledge, it's just like more for investment grade borrowers rather than high yield borrowers. So, and we are talking more about the high yield borrowers when we talk about non-bank lenders. Victoria, go ahead, please.
That is exactly the point, right? We need to kind of zoom on the, and it was an Effie's presentation, and that he said it's not across the borders. There are segments where this is concentrated, and he emphasized that it's in the a large cap space where the leverage is important. I would have thought that from there it would go into value-weighted observations as opposed to equally weighted. But the other point is, I actually typed it into the comment section, but if I recall correctly, of course it didn't escape the practitioners that leverage is measured on net debt basis. All the covenants are written on net debt basis, and all the leverage is plotted on net debt basis. So the leverage loan market, the average issuance for large firms is at 5.6 times EBITDA level right now. It was at 5.3 in 2007. In the middle market, it was in 4.7 in 2007, and it's about 5.5 or something like this. That's on the net debt. And these are the markets of the trillions of dollars that we are talking about. So that average encompassed that is interesting, but it seems like it doesn't add up this once we zoom on the segment that is been levering up, is a segment where the debt's been growing.
Okay, we are out of time. So thank you very much. Thank you to Ishel for the excellent paper and presentation. Victoria, thank you for your discussion. And let me remind everybody that we're now going to take a 15-minute break. We will return at 12:55, so 12:55 for the third paper of the day. So thanks, everybody. Welcome back, everyone. We're now ready to go to the third paper of the day. To recall, the first paper was on macroeconomic implications of the combination of high leverage and low interest rates. And the second paper focused more on regulatory issues raised by the role of non-bank lenders. Now we're going to look at a different issue that is also very much within the Federal Reserve's purview, and that's whether the lending that we see in the markets is rendering the economy more vulnerable to the coronavirus pandemic. And so our paper is by Christina Wang at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, together with her co-authors also at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston. So Christina, the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you so much, Ben. Good afternoon, everyone. This is, as Ben said, joint work with my colleagues, Falk Browning and Jose Filat, who, being nice guys, have volunteered to take on the hard job of answering the more difficult questions. And we all thank Kelly, who's in the audience, for her excellent research assistance. And we all very happy to have the opportunity to contribute to this conference. Okay, now before I start, let me not forget all the usual disclaimers apply. Okay, now what motivated us to write this paper? It is the historically high corporate leverage on the eve of COVID-19. And here on the left of the slide, you can see this picture using aggregate data from the financial accounts of the United States, where we plotted the time series of leverage defined as debt over capital income, which most closely correspond to so-called EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization. And you can see that in 2019 Q4, this ratio stands at the 97th percentile of the value between 1980 and up to that point. And then on the right, for comparison purpose, we also plotted this corresponding ratio of leverage, debt over EBITDA, using the microdata from the Y14Q data set that we'll be using for our analysis. And this data, unfortunately, starts only from 2012, but during the period when it overlaps with the aggregate data, the range of distribution is fairly comparable. In particular, the weighted average is fairly comparable to aggregate data. The weighted average is a little higher than the median, betraying 2.5 and 3 over the period since 2012, because the large firms tend to have higher leverage. Let me also note that this definition of leverage is going to be the key measure of leverage we focus on in our study. Okay. So given the historically high leverage at the outset or just before COVID-19 pandemic hit, we are naturally worried. In particular, because part of the reason, supposedly, the high debt was sustainable in some people's eyes because the interest rate was low, and therefore firms' earnings were able to foot the interest bill. However, COVID-19, what it did most notably was to destroy or greatly curtail firms' earning powers, especially at the outset. And so it's most concerning given the loss of earning ability. And also, even if in the aggregate, we think it might still be okay, given the distribution, there are some firms having a relatively high leverage ratio might be in trouble. And in particular, the small or medium-sized firms may be particularly in difficulty. And so in this study, we use data on non-financial firms, borrowing from Y14 Bank to study how the pre-COVID leverage affected firms' ability to access bank loans during COVID, and ultimately what's impact on their leverage during COVID. And so we pay special attention to the potential disparity experience of large versus small firms or mid-sized firms, so-called SMEs. There's no standard definition of SMEs in the literature. And so in this study, we define firm size based on sales. So small firms correspond to sales up to $50 million. This is also the definition used in the senior loan officer survey. And then for mid-sized firms, we define them to have sales from $50 million up to $250. And so lo and behold, we do find that leverage constrained SMEs, especially small firms, access to bank credit along some margins. In particular, it reduced the size of newly originated loans to SMEs, and it lowered small firms' probability of borrowing from a bank without prior relationship. And then when we zoom in to look at potential impact of bank capital sort of constraining their credit supply, we find that banks with more capital buffer cushion appear to be more willing to lend to higher leverage small firms during COVID, but only if they're existing or established customers. And then we'll also find some evidence of high leverage deterring investment during COVID among the SMEs, especially mid-sized firms. In a way, the impact of leverage on real activity is ultimately what we care about. And given our data, the real activity measure we focus on is investment. Okay, so before we delve into the empirical findings, which is meat of the paper, let me just start with a very simple stylized sort of illustrative model to get across the intuition about debt overhang, meaning the negative effect of exerted by leverage on firms' intent to invest. And so the basic idea is pretty straightforward. Just think about a firm with a risky existing asset that has a value A tilde, and then it has outstanding debt. And so the default probability is basically the delta, the probability of A tilde falls below the debt obligation. And so now imagine the firm has a temporary project that needs some investment in the first period and then pays off return big R in the second period, and assume that this project is marginal relative to the existing asset, so it would not affect the default probability, which is entirely determined by the existing asset. If the firm has to borrow to invest, then it's pretty clear that the firm would only invest if the return R exceeds the interest rate it would have to pay on the new borrowing, which is called gamma. And this gamma is determined by the firm's default probability delta and how much the firm would pay off in the default state, which you can see in the middle of the page in terms of the determination of gamma. And so it's very clear that in this case, the higher D, the existing leverage, the higher gamma, the how much the firm would have to pay in order to borrow to fund the investment. And so then the less likely the firm would be to take up this project. And so in this case, since gamma is also dependent on the risk premium, immediately we can see the effects or the beneficial effect of, say, Federal Reserve's timely intervention in the bond market. So when the Fed announced the two bond purchase programs, shortly after the market dysfunction at the onset of COVID, the corporate bond spreads basically retraced much of its spike initially. And in this, even in this simple setting, you can see that would greatly reduce the risk of debt overhang. And also, even in this simple setting, you can see that if the average shock, such as COVID-19, impairs the value of the existing asset, a tilde, for example, the negative effect of COVID on, say, retail industry or some of the service industries, effectively, it would be like raising their leverage because their default probability is now higher. And now one thing that from the very simple model of the large firm, we can see that the debt overhang problem actually would be there even without credit constraint, which describes the large firm's situation fairly well. But of course, if the small firms, in addition, also faces a credit constraint or borrowing constraint. In this case, say they can only borrow D up to a portion theta of their total assets, call it productive capital K. And in this case, we can easily show that the small firm's enterprise value is increasing in the amount of leverage it can get, meaning the higher theta, the higher the enterprise value. And so generally small firms facing such borrowing constraint will be maxing out its borrowing even prior to, say, any negative shock. And so in that case, when the shock such as COVID hit, then the small firms typically would have difficulty getting more funding in order to make necessary new investment. And so this shows that if the firm needs to make investment in order to weather the negative shock, it's very important for there to be public support or debt forbearance. Debt forbearance in particular would have added the benefit that it would generally help counter the potential of banks, for example, tightening the borrowing constraint, meaning lowering theta. And so after just going over these simple sort of intuition about why leverage can become a problem, and in particular, why leverage can become a bigger problem for small and medium firms. Let me just mention very quickly that our study builds upon a number of strands in the literature. In the interest of time, I unfortunately will have to skip the literature review. But suffice to say that we are hoping that, you know, we will be able to contribute to a lot of the important contributions that have already been made in these strands of literature. Okay, so let me take a minute to go over our data very quickly. So the main data set we're using is the so-called FRY14Q data set schedule H1 for initially designed for stress testing purposes. These are loan level data set that have to be submitted quarterly by banks with assets 100 billion or above. And they have to report every single C&I loans, which includes both lines of credit and term loans, with a committed balance of a million or more. And so the vast majority of the borrowers in this data set are private firms, and close to 60% of them are SMEs, according to our definition. And so this, we consider this a big advantage over some other more commonly used data sets, such as the DealScan or CompuStat, which tend to focus on the large or largest and mostly public firms. And so for each loan, the bank also has to report some of the major balance sheet income statement data on the borrower. Unfortunately, the borrower data, financial data often lag by a quarter or sometimes more. And so the most prevalent best reported would be data as of Q4 from the prior year. And that's what we're going to be using for our firm level analysis. So in our analysis, we use we consider only non-financial firms, and we use loan data from 2019 Q4 through 2020 Q4 to focus on the comparison between the pre-COVID period and the COVID period. Specifically, we defined the pre-COVID period to run from October 1st, 2019 through March 14th, 2020, and then the COVID period runs from March 15th through the end of 2020. This sample period is also chosen so that we have approximately a similar number of observations before versus the COVID period. Okay, so now after all that preamble setting the stage, we're ready to tackle the empirical results. Let me just very quickly preview the results pertaining to what's the effect of leverage on the availability of bank credit for SMEs. So we find that size of the newly originated loans by these Y14 banks contracted more for SMEs during the COVID period relative to the pre-COVID patterns. And this is especially pronounced for small firms. And also we find that the probability of obtaining loans from a bank without prior relationship fell for small firms with higher leverage. And we find some evidence that banks with more or a better capital buffer cushion were more willing to lend to riskier existing customers among the small firms, but not necessarily new ones during COVID. And so one special or almost unique feature of this COVID downturn is the unprecedented public support in terms of funding or lending from the fiscal and monetary authorities. And so you're probably familiar with the program such as the PPP, the Paycheck Protection Program, or the MSLP, which is the Main Street Lending Program. And so we want to study naturally what might be the impact of these public support programs on firms' behavior in terms of, say, loan access and also investment. And so in particular for loan access, I will show that one thing we specifically look at is to use regression discontinuity design around threshold leverage, which determines eligibility to participate in the Main Street program to try to identify its effect. We focus on Main Street program because this is the only program that has a very explicit leverage requirement. Okay, so now about the specific estimates. And so on this page, we report the effect of leverage on small firms' loan availability along what we call the intensive margin, specifically loan size, the first two columns, loan interest rate spread, second two columns, and the last two columns pertain to the utilization rate. And so I will draw your attention to the first row, which reports how the effect of leverage has changed during COVID versus pre-COVID. And you can see that the size of loans has fallen during COVID for those small firms with higher leverage. And it's present for both all the small firms, and also to some degree it's larger, slightly larger effect, but a little less significance for the smaller sample of firms that are particularly or adversely impacted by firms in those industries. We identify those firms by their industry, firms in those industries that are particularly impacted by COVID, which is the second column. Okay, so now moving on to what we would call the extensive margin of bank lending, and what's the effect of leverage on these extensive margins. And so the odd columns pertain to all the small firms, and the even columns pertain to only firms in those industries that were adversely affected by COVID. And we look at three measures. The first measure is what we call new borrower, or the probability that a new loan was issued to a borrower. To a borrower that didn't have prior relationship with that bank. And then we also look at the refinancing probability, meaning whether a firm was able to refinance a loan in the quarter when it had a loan or more maturing in that quarter. And so we see that the effect is concentrated along the new borrower margin. And so you can see that for the small firms during COVID, their probability of borrowing from a bank without prior relationship fell significantly. Okay, now we run the same regressions for the firms in the other size groups as well. And we summarize the coefficients on this slide. So each panel corresponds to a specific left-hand side, as we saw in the previous tables. And then the red markers correspond to those firms, the red squares correspond to those firms that are hard hit by COVID, and then the blue diamonds correspond to all the firms within each given size group. And the first pair of markers would map exactly to the coefficients we just saw in the previous two tables. And then the first three size groups constitute what we call the SMEs, meaning firms with sales up to 250 million. And so I would draw your attention in particular to the first panel, the top left, and you can see that perhaps the most consistent and significant effect of leverage during COVID on loan availability to small firms or to SMEs in general is that the loan size shrank the higher the leverage a firm had. Okay, so next, we want to zero in more on the potential effect of bank capital and whether that may cause some supply constraint in a particular form. And so we look at what's the impact of bank capital buffer or excess capital buffer, which is defined as the ratio of tier one risk-based capital above and beyond the required ratio, which the requirement includes both the 4.5 minimum and the 2% capital conservation buffer and whatever the G-SIB surcharge for these large banks are. And then we divide banks into two groups, the ones that have excess buffer, capital buffer above the median value. We call them high capital buffer banks. And then the rest would be the ones that have the buffer value below the median. And so if you look at, focus on the third row of coefficients reported in this table, which shows you the effect of banks with high capital buffer, how they lent to firms during the COVID period, depending on the borrower's leverage. And you can see that those banks with higher capital buffers were willing to help risky borrowers, existing borrowers. These are all small firms, existing borrowers during COVID. This is the second column, the third row coefficient. However, if you look at the last two columns, the banks with higher capital buffer are no more willing to help new customers. And then if you just quickly look at the first row of the coefficient, you can see that basically those coefficients confirm the pattern we had shown before in general, that loan size shrank and probably they'll become a new borrowers fell for small firms during COVID. And now, so we, as I mentioned before, we want to look at the effect of the Main Street Lending Program. And this is the only lending program that has explicit threshold requirement. And so we look at this to see, in particular, there is the threshold of 4, which determines ability to participate in the new loan facility. And so we look at only those firms that size eligible for MSLP, and they have leverage between 3.5 to 4.5, and the 3.5 to 4 is the omitted category. And we can see here, if you look at the first row, and the first three columns shows the coefficient on the dummy for the higher than 4 leverage. And the last, before COVID, and the last three rows shows the corresponding coefficient for the COVID period. And if you compare the effect on loan size and spread, you can see that during COVID, the firms that have leveraged just above this threshold show signs of basically substituting or shifting toward bank loans, meaning they borrowed more and they got charged higher spread. And so it shows there's some effect that the Main Street program has helped those firms eligible in terms of leverage to obtain public funding, whereas the ones that are less eligible because of the leverage constraint seem to have shifted toward private bank loans. Okay, so now let me very quickly wrap up by talking about what's probably our more sort of greater interest effect, which was leverage on investment by small firms. And so here we report the effect of leverage on investment before COVID period, the first two columns, and then during the COVID period. And these regressions control for a very rich set of fixed effects, like the bank quarter, industry quarter, state quarter, and also firm characteristics, loan sales, sales growth, liquidity, and profitability, and asset tangibility. We're only reporting the leverage coefficient for brevity or clarity. And the comparison between the COVID and pre-COVID coefficient and the standard error is reported in the last two rows. So you can see that indeed for these small firms, that the effect of leverage became more negative during COVID periods, although that effect is not quite significant. It's very marginally significant. And now if we run the same regressions for firms in the other size groups and plot the coefficients here, again, the blue diamond is for all the firms within each size category, and then the red squares for those firms and industries that are heavily impacted. And you can see that the first set of the first pair of markers correspond to exactly the coefficients we just saw in the previous table. And then if you look at across the first three groups, these are the SMEs, you can see that the negative effect of leverage on investment was particularly pronounced and significant for the size group from 50 to 100 million. So comparing or combining the effect we found on loans and also the effect we're finding here in terms of the investment, we think that this pattern overall suggests that the small firms might have been helped, at least during this episode, by the public funding support programs such as PPP, whereas the mid-sized firms are probably not getting as much support. Whereas on the other side, if you look at the really large firms, you can see actually their leverage became less a deterrent on investment during COVID period. It's very likely that these large firms greatly benefit from the corporate bond buying programs by the Federal Reserve. So that's basically is all the messages that we have. Very quickly conclude that we do find some evidence using borrower level information on these small and medium sized firms that pre-COVID leverage did have some negative effect on bank loan availability and also has some deterrent effect on investment during COVID, especially for the mid-sized firms, possibly because the policy support for them didn't quite reach as broadly. Thank you very much. We look forward to Simon's discussion, and we want to express our special thanks to Simon for having to come up with comments during a pretty short time span he had. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Christina. Before turning to Simon, let me remind all participants that we're going to have a session with questions for Christina and also for Simon, I suppose. And so if you have questions based on Christina's paper or her presentation, you can go ahead now and submit those questions, and we'll turn to them immediately after Simon speaks. So, Simon, we're now ready for you. Our discussant is Simon Gilchrist from NYU.
Great. Well, it's a real pleasure to be here and to actually think about and talk about this paper. It's a very rich paper with quite a bit of detail in it. Sorry, my slides aren't, there we go. Okay, so Christina gave a great description of the paper. Basically, they're using the Y14 micro banking data to examine the role of leverage in lending patterns during the pandemic. And the way I think about this, the question being addressed is, leverage is high when you look at something like the debt to asset ratio of companies or the debt to income ratios, but it's clearly low when you look at earnings to interest payments. Okay, so earnings relative to interest payments are an all-time high as well, right? And so not just during the pandemic, but going forward, there's going to be this question about as rates rise and we return to some sort of normalization, what happens to these firms' balance sheets in terms of their indebtedness vis-a-vis their willingness or ability to pay? Okay, so just to remind people, this Y14 data is incredibly rich data. In the 2008-2009 financial crisis and Great Recession, one of the things that hobbled researchers was a lack of actual data on new loans issued. Somewhat astoundingly, we didn't actually sort of see, even at the aggregate, new loans issued. We just saw the stock of loans outstanding. And so the Y14 data actually contains individual loan data on new loans issued with loan quantities and prices. So we can see both the stock outstanding and the new loans. It has broad coverage that includes many non-publicly traded firms, so small and medium-sized enterprises. And then I think the one caveat is that when you sort of look at the sample, reading the appendix, it looks like we start out with like 100,000 loans. And then once we sort of select on the various criteria that we require that there's information available, we're down to a sample of somewhere around 9,000. And, you know, and then in some of these regressions, you know, they're sort of samples of 2,000 to 3,000 or 700 observations, right? And so, so the final sample, I think, is not maybe as rich as one might hope for. And I think that's partly just because it focused on a very specific episode. So what are the key findings? So as Christina documented, there are these intensive margin effects. Small firms with high leverage took out smaller loans on average during the pandemic. Relatedly, though, there's a number of sort of findings in the paper where we don't really see any relationship between leverage and the sort of variables that you might be interested in. So there's no discernible effects of leverage on the credit spreads, or there's no discernible effects on credit lines and utilization. In terms of extensive margin effects, it's clear that small firms with high leverage are less likely to establish a new lending relationship during the pandemic. On the other hand, there doesn't really seem to be any effect of leverage on the propensity of a firm to refinance an existing loan. So, there are places where leverage shows up, and then there are places where you might think it should show up, and it doesn't necessarily show up. So investment spending has a strong negative effect on these large firms' investment during the pandemic, but it doesn't seem to have any effect on investment spending of the small firms during the pandemic. Okay, so so one might ask then, what are the lessons to be drawn in, you know, broadly speaking here? And one of them is just the causal inference here is a challenge. There's lots of reasons to have to think hard about the endogeneity of leverage and then selection effects going on in the data and things like that. And so I think that, and as the paper sort of discusses, some of the results may be driven by such issues. And then broadly speaking, we're always asking this question, can we separate credit demand effects from credit supply effects? And then when we talk about credit supply versus credit demand, it sort of depends on who you're asking what constitutes credit demand versus credit supply. And so we could think about there being effects that come from banks who are less willing to lend right now. And that doesn't really seem to be the driving force during this period. Or we could think about there being impairment of the balance sheet of firms, which make it harder for them to get loans. And so one, you know, might typically label that a credit supply effect. So, okay, just a snapshot of what went on during the crisis, as Christina alluded to, there was severe disruption in a variety of financial markets as the crisis unfolded. So this is a snapshot of the corporate bond market. I've got two lines here. One is the spreads over treasuries on investment grade bonds. And the other, that's the blue line, and that's the left axis. And the right line is the high yield spreads, okay? And so they move strikingly together during this episode. The investment grade spreads peak at 400 basis points. The high yield spreads peak at 1,000 basis points. So these are, numbers that, we haven't seen since the Great Recession financial crisis. And, there are these sort of Fed actions that take place, and I've written about this, but to sort of bring these down with these sort of announcements of willingness to purchase corporate bonds and things like that. But, nonetheless, these spreads remain elevated for considerable time, especially the high yield spreads, throughout certainly July of 2020. So, you might expect then that there are these spillovers also into the lending markets of bank lending. To see this a little more clearly, this is a measure of the excess bond premium using daily data. So this is a measure of what we think about as a risk premium on the corporate bond market. And so that run up in investment grade bonds of 400 basis points, about more than 300 basis points of that, looks to not really be about the default risk component of these corporate spreads, but more about a risk premium demanded by investors during this time period. So Now, I think it's worth keeping this in mind when you see movements like this in the corporate bond sector, and then you look at the spreads that you see in the banking sector. The spreads in the banking sector are moving by something like 20 basis points, not by 300 basis points. And so, again, I think that speaks to the fact that there are these selection mechanisms, this credit rationing going on and things like that in the bank market that's not occurring in the corporate bond market. And that's both the interesting part about this paper, but also I think the challenge in terms of teasing things out. Okay, I want to give you a couple other data pictures here. This is small business activity. This is based on this well-known data set, Homebase. This is for all sectors covered by Homebase. You can see that the activity of these small businesses fell by about 60% by April 2020, and it recovered to about 30% by end of October 2020. Now, one thing, I'm going to come back to this, but a large fraction of this, two-thirds of this decline in activity is businesses just shutting their doors. And only a third of that decline is employment per merchant declining. And so there's a lot of activity here where businesses just shut their doors and, some of them are coming back online and some aren't. So, if you look, that's all sectors. And if you look at leisure and hospitality, which includes restaurants and things like that, the picture is exactly the same. So. Okay, so this paper is going to estimate regressions of the following form. It's going to regress a variable YIT of firm I at time T. That could be the new loan amount or the credit spread obtained or credit utilization of a line of credit on the leverage of that firm, and interacted with a COVID dummy, which is dated from March 2020, March 15, 2020 onward. And then we're going to have a variety of firm-specific controls. Those, I think, are somewhat dated in the sense that you might want contemporaneous information on things like sales or profitability, but it's all going to be sort of at the end of 2019, that data. So, but we're going to have a series of time dummies that are going to kind of try and saturate things with both industry times dummies and state times dummies as well. So, what's great about the paper is they have this very extensive appendix. And, one of the things I was concerned about is that there might be this sort of interaction between, say, profitability and COVID or something like that. And in the paper, it contains all these interaction terms, regression. So that's actually very nicely done. So some of the key findings again. So leverage matters for small firm loan volume. I was trying to figure out the exact quantity. It would be nice if they put it in the paper. I think I got the numbers right. The coefficients are multiplied by 100, but I think a one standard deviation of leverage is like 5%, and the coefficient is like 2%, but that was multiplied by 100. So I think in log points, that means a one standard deviation difference in leverage would imply a 10% differential in the amount of a given loan. Okay, so that seems a reasonable size to think about. But again, leverage doesn't matter for the credit spreads or for the credit line utilization rates. And that's a bit of a puzzle, I would think, in the sense that one would think that if you're credit constrained and you've got a line available, that you would try and draw it down. Now, there's a literature on this banks can revoke these lines under certain conditions and things like that. But there's a sense in which, we see this in one place, but we don't see it in another. And I'm a little curious about why exactly that's going on. There's also, once you include these interaction effects, if you look in the appendix, then the sort of leverage effects in the baseline specification seem to kind of disappear on you. Now, but what does seem to sort of look robust is if you consider like a nonlinearity of the firms that have very high leverage, is leverage being greater than 4, that seems to be very robust regardless of what you throw in the regression. And so it would be nice to kind of explore a little bit more this sort of robustness aspect of these findings, I think, in the paper. Again, in terms of extensive margin effects, leverage matters for the propensity of the small firms to establish a new banking relationship. It doesn't seem to matter for this loan refinancing. And here the results do seem robust to sort of the inclusion of these interaction terms that are documented in the appendix, which is nice. Okay, so one of the first things I just wondered about was, it's not exactly clear to me why I want to measure leverage as loans to earnings. Conceptually, you know, we could think about there being something like the loan to capital, or, you know, the debt to asset ratio, something like that. And then if we're going to look at like an earnings measure, it would be reasonable to think about, you know, especially during this time period, to look at something like the interest payments to earnings as being the right characteristic, especially since no one thought interest payments are going anywhere anytime soon, interest rates. So the other concern is that this is a very nonlinear measure. You know, so we get these firms with very low earnings and their leverage is going to be very high, not because of any inherent debt that they've recently taken on, but simply because they've had some bad shocks recently and their earnings measures are low, right? And so the question then is, where is the information coming from? Is it, and earnings are very volatile, we know that, right? And so I'm a little concerned that there's sort of this volatility of the earnings measure, which is just a snapshot of a point in time in 2019 Q4 that might drive things. And I think it would be nice to see some more robustness here in terms of how to measure these things. In particular, you might be worried that if it's just about the earnings measure, then you know, we're picking up high leverage firms are effectively these firms with currently low earnings. So they might be likely to exit or downsize regardless of what's going on in the credit conditions during this episode. And so again, that speaks to, is this about the demand versus the supply channel? And I think doing some, you know, a little bit more robustness to show some clean separation here would be very useful. There's also this truncation issue. So, you know, if you have negative earnings, you can't use this measure. So at the minimum, you might want to just flip it and use the inverse of leverage. So earnings divided by debt rather than debt divided by earnings. And again, because there seems to be this strong action out in the tail of the distribution, you know, thinking about, although you only truncate 5% of the sample, say, it could be a 5% that matters a lot for your estimates. So, okay. Now, the paper is very clear that intensive margin effects are compounded by selection, right? And so these are the firms that are receiving a new loan, and they're clearly going to be different than firms that aren't receiving a loan during this time period. You can ask the same, I think, about extensive margin effects. So who is out there seeking to establish a new lending relationship and why? And so, you know, if you're a business that's basically shutting its doors for a while, then you might not really have any need for new credit, and you might not be trying to establish any type of new loan, let alone a new lending relationship. And so, I you know, it's not clear to me that looking at extensive versus intensive margins sort of solves any selection type issues that we might be concerned about. So, again, I would like to see a little bit more discussion about that. And then I'm really struck by these investment findings because, you know, it's really clear that there's a strong effect of these highly levered but large firms doing a lot of investment, but these highly levered smaller firms are not doing much as much investment, but these highly levered smaller firms is no obvious effect. And we're not talking about the smallest of the small here. We're talking about a pretty wide range of the size distribution, where there doesn't seem to be any effective leverage on investment. And I find that a bit of a puzzle, to be honest, if leverage is such a strong force during this episode. Okay, so broadly speaking, I think about these selection effects and endogeneity concerns as one, you know, who exactly has high leverage? You know, it's reasonable to think that if you have good access to credit and things like that, you will go ahead and borrow and end up with high leverage. And that's sort of a common issue in this literature. Who actually gets a loan during this time period? Who actually applies for a loan? And then also importantly, I think who survives the actual pandemic? Okay, so Okay, and so let me just kind of end up with a couple of slides here off from the paper. So I found this to be a very interesting slide. So this is the number of loans issued, and these are the small firms, 50 million in sales and below. And the green line are the low leverage small firms, and then the gold line is the high leverage small firms. And, you know, there's really no difference in terms of the number of loans taken out by these two groups during this time period. That's the left panel. So, you know, again, to a first order, I'm left wondering how much leverage actually matters when I see a plot like this. Now, and then even more somewhat, you know, maybe more confounding, I would say, is that it's the guys with the low leverage that have the higher credit spreads on average, right? And it's the guys with the low leverage that really see a big jump up in their credit spreads by 20 basis points, which looks like a large move for this banking data. And so again, this sort of speaks to some kind of a selection mechanism, maybe where it's the low leverage guys are actually the worst quality in some way, and their spreads jump up relative to these high leverage guys that are in some way better quality. And so this link of leverage to credit quality, I think, is, you know, bears further scrutiny here. Okay, and then if you look at the large firm, you actually see kind of the opposite pattern, which is that there is this sort of episode here where there's a divergence in lending between the high leverage guys and the low leverage guys, but it's the high leverage guys that get more loans, okay, when the crisis unfolds, this pandemic unfolds. It doesn't last that long, but it looks like this period where, you know, maybe this is precautionary borrowing by these firms, that they're high leverage, they're worried about rollover, and so they go and take out as many loans as they can right now. Now, but what's interesting here is that while the lending spikes up, their spreads drop by 20 basis points, you know? And so again, this is like a selection effect, I think, where certain firms are moving into the market that maybe weren't there before, and they're actually high quality, high leverage firms. And when they're borrowing, they're actually getting reasonable terms for their borrowing. So this is, I think, you know, these two pictures, I think, highlight the challenges of the identification schemes that we're trying to tease out. What does leverage mean for the cycle during this episode? So, and then I'm just going to end on one picture, which is, again, from this home-based data. And I think this really kind of hits home at like the selection effect and the number of operating businesses. So I think the home-based guys are probably in, you know, really the small tail of the size distribution here, you know, less than 5 million in sales kind of thing. But you can systematically see that they're total. And so each of these dots is like a state at a point in time. Okay. So, and you can see the different calendar times, like black is January, February, March, May. It's pretty consistent across the entire period that there's a strong negative relationship between the number of operating businesses and the total revenue that we're seeing in this sector. So basically, you know, to a first order, it's like either businesses are open and active or they're kind of not, right? And so, you know, I think by definition, this Y14 data is going to miss this sort of margin of these firms that are just shutting down and then not seeking new credit. So, you know, in some sense, one might think that's going to give you an underestimate of any kind of leverage effects that you have. But at the same time, there are enough kind of puzzling or results that go sort of in somewhat different ways than what we would expect in the paper that I'm not exactly sure how to interpret where the selection might show up. So, okay. So again, it's a super careful study, and you know, what's great about the paper is they put all of the results in the paper and they talk about all of these results systematically. And then there are some that really do sort of go in the direction of leverage really mattering. But I think there are also some others where it's not so obvious that this leverage effect is really kicking in a strong way. So, and then my final point is that, you know, if you look kind of in the details, there are these other measures of risk that the banks use to sort of classify the firms, and that doesn't line up that well with leverage. And again, I think that's consistent with this idea that leverage is at best an imperfect proxy for the risk of, that these firms have taken on. So nonetheless, I think as we go forward and as we sort of think about rate normalizations, then the fact that these interest payments to earnings are at historically low levels, I think, is a concern. Should things normalize again in the next couple of years. So I'll stop here.
Great. Thank you, Simon. Christina, do you want to take a minute or two to respond to some of the, I thought, very insightful observations that Simon had, especially on the estimation and the results and the role of question identification questions?
Absolutely. Thanks, Ben. And really a tremendous amount of thanks to Simon for really very thoughtful discussion. We appreciate, in particular, we appreciate that you helped present some of the results that I had to cut out because of the time constraint. And we had a lot more the stuff in the paper that just I couldn't cover. And so I think, you know, you raised a lot of very valid points and some of which we have amongst ourselves, we have actually discussed repeatedly, and we're still thinking, I mean, it's still somewhat a work in progress in the sense we're still thinking about how best to address, in particular, I guess I would just speak to the issue about selection. That is the key reason why we want to look at the extensive margin, because we are aware that there is a lot of selection issue, especially regarding the intensive margin, because you're already observing that these firms got loans. But of course, as you pointed out, the extensive margin is not entirely, say, free from the selection issue. So we did look at, I don't have the time to kind of get into a lot of the detail, but for example, we did look at, as you mentioned, that, you know, maybe using the pre-COVID sort of right-hand side controls might be problematic. Things changed a lot after COVID hit. And so we did look at, for example, if you look at sales after the COVID hit, and we do observe some evidence that the firms that are able to borrow still show up in the Y14 data set. They tend to have less sort of negative change or less decline in sales by industry relative to those that if we don't control for, you know, that they show up in 2019 and show up in 2020. And so there's definitely indication that there is selection. And we, I mean, the reason we use the lag values is in part to study regarding leverage. We want to focus on, you know, what is the impact of pre-COVID, like pre-shock leverage on firms' behavior or their experience after the shock hit, and also follow the typical convention. We use the pre-shock sort of precondition as right-hand side controls, but it's entirely quite possible because of the nature of this shock that some of the pre-shock patterns may not be relevant when it comes to, say, banks trying to assess a firm's risk, right? So that's definitely the case. And we've been thinking, we continue to think about what's the best way to capture that kind of selection without incurring you know, any further sort of endogeneity or simultaneity problem. And then regarding the, say, using, for example, the pre-COVID debt to earnings as the measure that as the leverage measure. So yes, there is the possibility that it might be sort of a more a point in time, and therefore these could be firms that just experienced negative shock in terms of earnings. But the earnings we're using, because of the nature of the data, the earnings is actually for 2019 as a whole, the whole year, not just the 2019 Q4. So it kind of alleviates that problem a little bit. I mean, not entirely, it limited it And so, I think, as you pointed out, there is definitely evidence in terms of selection, and also evidence in terms of leverage may not be the most, relevant risk measure, in the sense that there is endogeneity. You can imagine that why would a firm be allowed to have such high leverage, right? Because it must have some other properties along some other dimensions to mitigate the risk imposed by leverage. And so that's why we have these regressions where we directly say, for example, put in the measure of banks' assessment of a borrower's credit risk, try to see to what degree that leverage may be serving as a sort of proxy for risk. And we do find that once you put in those other measures of risk, that it does take away to varying degrees the exponential power of leverage. So we can think of a leverage as more a measure of just sort of proxy for risk. And also going back to what you said, that if we think that these firms have properties that enable them to take on more leverage, then the fact that even they are having trouble, you could sort of infer that maybe the ones that weren't able to take on leverage, they might have been in even bigger trouble. And plus, as you said, going forward, you know, as the effect of public policy support kind of wanes, and as interest rate normalize, you could certainly see that leverage comes to bite with greater force. And so all of these considerations sort of prompt us to give leverage more a role in terms of thinking about the potential negative effect on the economy. Thank you so much.
Great. Christina, thank you for that. Now, we have one question so far in the chat, and so let me read it for you. Akos Horvath asked the following question. Considering that more levered firms might have worse banking relationships, that's a bit of the opposite, I think, of what you and the problem that you and Simon were just talking about, but it says, considering that more levered firms might have worse banking relationships, which might drive some of the results, do the authors think that it would make more sense to control for a bank borrower effects? In a similar vein, would it be possible to control for firm fixed effects to reduce bias from omitted potentially latent variables? Do you have anything to say in response to Mr. Horvath?
Let me just say very quickly, it's a possibility, but as Ben, you pointed out, it goes in the opposite direction. So we did actually consider further imposing firm fixed effect. One issue, as Simon pointed out in his discussion, that we do have attrition greatly. And so if you further restrict to have those firms that have to exist both before and after in the data set, we're left with a rather small data set. And so we may be able to control for the firm fixed effect better, but on the other hand, the selection margin may be even more sort of exacerbated. So it's a bit of a trade-off.
Great. And now I have a question or two of my own. And Simon, you're welcome to weigh in on this as well. And these questions, Christina, are prompted by the a kind of tension between what's in your paper and what was in Efi Benmelech's paper from the first session this morning, that one of the Efi's interesting findings was that firms do not seem to borrow for the purpose of investment, or at least they do so to a very small extent. Really striking how little of the proceeds of debt were being used to finance investment. And yet, at least in the virus period, you find this negative effect of leverage on firms' willingness or ability to undertake investment. Do you have any thoughts about what would make the negative effect on investment in this period show up in a way that's not consistent with the general pattern by which firms don't use borrowings to pay for investment?
I would love to hear Simon's thoughts on this. So we have thought pretty hard about this issue. We recognize, in particular, if you talk about credit lines, typically these are taken out for working capital purpose, not kind of directly to finance investment. And so we try to look at there are a couple of things. First of all, our focus on small firms may make that sort of disconnect a little less important, in the sense that small firms rely to a much greater degree on bank loans. In particular, they probably rely more on term loans to make investment. And so that helps and that makes their behavior probably somewhat different from what you would find using data on large firms. And then the other thing we found that there's some evidence that even though firms may not use, say, credit lines to make to pay for investment directly, but there's some evidence that they seem to take out bigger lines when they are doing more investment, when they're having, say, higher investment rate. And our interpretation is to say that they're probably also thinking about having a little more liquidity while they're making more expenditures. And so there is some kind of evidence of the indirect connection. And so those would be, I think, our first order answer to why we may be seeing more a connection between investment and loans for the small firms.
Well, those are both interesting thoughts. And to clarify, you're right that Effie was looking at the universe of CompuStat firms, and that's a different size category than you're studying. Simon, do you have any view on the issue of whether firms are either directly or, as Christina points out, indirectly using the borrowings in order to pay for investment? And if not, why this would have looked different during the virus period?
So I didn't see Effie's presentation this morning. I think it is interesting to think about the non-CompuStat firms. And you know, Shebnam and co-authors had a very nice paper using the Y14 data, I believe, on the EFG program, talking about, you know, the various aspects of the characteristics of loans that the small firms are getting and things like that. And I'd have to kind of go back and look at that to think about how that ties into their investment spending directly. It would be nice to have a broader snapshot of that, I agree. And I don't think Shuddenham had like the investment regressions in her paper.
No, they don't. Yeah.
So it'd be nice to kind of go back and look at that, I think, in sort of the broader context. You know, my view of the pandemic is that, at least for these small guys, expansion opportunities were off the table. And, you know, they're just trying to figure out if they're going to keep their doors open or not. And can they get the working capital to keep the business running and to, you know, give the employees their paychecks and things like that. And some of them managed to get PPP loans, but that didn't always seem to be a smooth process, right? And so I think of this very much about like working capital needs during this time period and the extent to which you could access, say, bank loans for working capital needs. And I think this is one aspect of that. I think it might be interesting if you guys can delve in a little bit more into the details of the bank data and see whether or not, you know, some of this is more pointed towards working capital needs, or, you know, what are the industries where working capital really is like this driving force. You know, if you can't pay your suppliers, you can't, you know, order new supplies, things like that, right? And so So Ben, I think that's the way I think about it. And I think the investment thing, I'm not necessarily surprised that it doesn't show up in the data for the small guys. I'm kind of more puzzled by the fact that it kind of does show up in the data for these large guys. And you know, it'd be nice to know who those guys are. And certainly something out of CompuStat ought to tell us a lot for I think your investment findings, right? So I really do want to emphasize, I think this is about employment for the small firms. And you know, continuing is an ongoing concern. So
Simon, picking up on your point about working capital, and now a question for you, Christina, just to clarify, one of the issues in Effie's paper was the difference between gross and net leverage having to do with cash holdings. What he showed was that firms have been holding a lot of cash. This is not during his paper wasn't about the virus period the way yours is, but just more the trend is for firms to hold a lot of cash and indeed to use a fair amount of the borrowing proceeds in order to fund cash. Now that sounds something like Simon's working capital story. So Christina, just to clarify, when you have a leverage variable in your regression, was that a gross or a net leverage measure?
It's a gross leverage measure. It's just that, but we do in the investment regression, we do actually control for firms' cash holding. We call that liquidity.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because it might be interesting to see. I mean since again, Effie's emphasis was on the divergence in recent years between gross and net leverage, and so it might be interesting to see whether, if you reframed your regression to have the leverage variable be net instead of gross, then maybe you would get a different result. We have time about for one more question. And so I wanted to ask you, Christina.
Ben, can I?
Oh, I'm sorry, sure, Simon. Yes, yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
So I think if you have cash, it would be interesting to kind of look at, you know, how cash might have affected like sales, right? Like, I don't think you have employment data, but you have sales data, right? And so, you know, I this meltdown of these financial markets, the corporate bond markets, was, you know, a dash for cash. Everybody started selling everything. And the biggest meltdown occurred in the short end of the most liquid part of the market, because that's what you could dump the quickest, right? And so again, I think during this time period, I would think lots of people were trying to get their hands on cash. And among these small businesses, I think those who had the cash were more likely to be able to weather things. And so I think there's sort of a natural extension here that would be really interesting, is to move beyond leverage to cash holdings. So.
Yeah, I think that's very insightful. Christina, one last question, which is about all we have time for, I'm sorry. And that is whether there you have any insights, I hope not, but if we have a renewed kind of virus turndown and we once again have to resort to public funding assistance for these, for firms, as Simon says, to keep them going. Do you think we've learned anything about how we can design these public funding programs better than we did last time?
I have some thoughts, but I'm not sure we have the time to talk about all of it. So I would put in a plug for one of our colleagues, Gustavo Hakim, his work looking at the PPP funding, you know, whether they have a paper, he and his co-author have a paper looking at how PPP funding can be dispensed better. For example, you may want to target more the small firms, and then you may want to say, think about what banks' incentives are and try to design taking that into account. And then for MSLP, the Main Street program, which was more intended to target the medium sized firms, maybe we want to do a better job in terms of so relaxing the leverage constraints to some degree. And possibly making the process of participating administratively speaking, a little less onerous. That would be helpful. There are additional things that you know, I'm happy to talk about it, but I, you know, I don't know whether Simon has something to say as well.
Yes, Simon, how about you? If you were in charge of either Main Street or PPP next time, which incidentally wouldn't be a bad idea if I put in a word, but if you were in charge of either or both of those next time, is there something that you would do differently?
Well, it definitely seemed like some of the terms on these loans were not that attractive, right? I mean, that's one of the issues. But again, I haven't studied this carefully, but it's also the case, I think, how you implement this matters. And it seems like Switzerland had a very successful kind of PPP version where they, you know, managed to get loans out very quickly from the banks, and the banks had the right incentives to make the loans. And it doesn't seem like we quite designed the program where the banks had strong incentives to make the loans. So, but again, there are many other people I'm sure who are listening that thought much harder about exactly how to do this, Ben. So, but thank you for your confidence.
Okay. Well, thanks to you, Christina, for a splendid paper and an excellent presentation. And Simon, thank you for a very insightful discussion. The organizers have asked, we're about to close. The organizers have asked me to take care of first several housekeeping items. First of all, in a moment, each participant will see on his or her screen an invitation to complete a brief survey. So please do that. We're economists. We believe more information is better. And so knowing how people respond to today's program is always helpful. Second, for people who have not yet read the papers or who would like to see the PowerPoints from the presenters and the discussants, those will all be shortly available on the conference website. And if anyone you know missed the broadcast, the recording will also be available as of Tuesday morning at the same website. And thirdly, we hope we'll see everybody here when the conference reconvenes tomorrow morning at 9:30. Remember that it's necessary to register separately for each of the 3 days of the conference. So if you have not already registered for tomorrow and for Wednesday, please go ahead and do that. And we hope to see everyone here again tomorrow and Wednesday. And with that, let me thank everyone, both presenters and discussants and also participants. I think it's been a very good day. So thank you very much. And with that, we're adjourned.